stopped doing drugs. I stopped selling drugs. Gave up all my sin, gave up all my friends, all the partying.
I know these things. I was taught these things by Jesus Christ.
The things of the world, the sowing into my flesh. And I just sought God.
There was this fruit that was testifying that you know, I was on the right path.
That I have the truth. All those idols I got rid of as quickly as I could.
There are many, many Christians who say that you have to repent of your sins to be saved unto eternal life, or words to that effect.
The Bible says, unless you repent, you will perish. Unless you turn from your sin, you're going to burn in hell.
First, you have to be willing to repent of your sin.
He's talking about the repentance for sins, so that we can be saved.
And that's why I say we must turn from all known sin. A person cannot be a Christian. A person cannot be saved. A person cannot receive eternal life if he harbors in his life any known sin.
There are many false teachers out there teaching that repentance does not mean turning from sins.
What is repentance? It's to turn from sin.
Repent and be baptized. Sin no more.
Repent from your sins.
Turning away from sin.
Repentance from sin.
You gotta turn from your sins.
To repent of your sins.
Turning from sin.
Turning from our sin.
Turn from their sins.
Repent from our sin.
Turn from your sins.
Face and forsake your sins.
Turning away from sin.
Repent of our sins.
Repent of your sins.
When they repent of their sin.
To repent from their sin.
Turn from sins.
Turn away from sin.
I repent of my sins.
Repent of their sins.
Turn from your sin.
Turn from your sin.
Turning from sin.
Repenting of your sin.
Turning from sin.
Repenting of your sin.
Repent of your sins.
Repent of your sins.
Repent and forsake all known sin.
Turn from your sin.
We repent, we turn away from sin.
The repentance of sin.
Turning away from sin.
Turning from is sin.
You repented totally of your sins.
The correction of sin.
Confess and forsake your sins.
Repent of all your sin.
Repents of their sin.
Turn you from your sin.
Repent of your sins.
Repent of your sins, pal.
In July 2022, No Nonsense Christianity published a documentary that set out to disprove the repent of your sins to be saved gospel message. The documentary demonstrated that the exact verbatim phrase, repent of your sins, is never found in the Bible once.
The words repent of your sins are not found once in the Bible.
It demonstrated that many Christians take verses that use the word repentance and add the words of sins onto the verses, when those verses say no such thing.
Whenever they see the word repent, these people, they just automatically add of your sin, don't they?
It demonstrated that God repented, and we know that God has no sin. Therefore, repentance cannot automatically mean to turn from sins, otherwise that would make God a sinner.
But, you know what, people taking this verse would be like, wow, God repents. Yeah, he does.
It demonstrated that the Bible uses the word repentance in a secular context, that one can repent of many things which are not necessarily anything to do with turning from sin or salvation.
A person can repent from anything. They can repent from something good, they can repent of something bad, they can repent of a decision that they made. It's just a turning or changing course or changing direction. It doesn't have to be repenting of your sins.
It demonstrated that the biblical path to salvation is to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. To repent for the remission of sins is to turn away from trusting in something other than Jesus, such as one's own works, towards trusting in Jesus alone in order to receive this remission.
If repenting of your sins was something that we had to do to be saved, wouldn't God tell us that? So why do all these preachers say you have to repent of your sins to be saved when the term repent of your sins is never found in the Bible once? I mean, isn't that a fair question? If the Bible never one time says repent of sin, and that's something that we have to do to be saved, Good night! Why didn't he warn us? Why didn't he tell us? But look, I have hundreds of verses that say believe. Why? Because believing is what you have to do to be saved.
It demonstrated that obtaining forgiveness of sins by repenting of sins or by surrendering yourself to God is unbiblical and comes from false religions such as Hinduism and false holy books such as the Book of Mormon.
Simply by surrendering to me completely.
You give us sincere repentance and complete repentance for all of our sins.
Sin no more. And that's what even Jesus used to tell in his congregation. Sin no more. Repent.
It's because you've surrendered and you say to the Guru, I fall at your feet and I've lost and I need you now.
At least when I think about repentance, I think of it as like a big deal. I need to have a broken heart and a contrite spirit, and I need to have that change of heart. I need to feel that sorrow and that guilt and be ready to change my life and give up that sin and stop doing it.
Well, like Paul, we've repented over our past sins. We've confessed them to the extent necessary.
I do most earnestly repent of my transgressions.
Because, I mean, I searched the Bible, repent of your sins, repent of sin, it just isn't there. Yet preachers are constantly saying it. I searched the Book of Mormon and it just keeps coming up.
And finally, it demonstrated that when turning from sin is the context of repentance, such as in Acts chapter 8 or Revelation chapter 2, that these passages are intended for God's own people. They are not intended to give the gospel to tell an unsaved person how to be saved.
So prior to that whole event taking place, what do we see him doing? Believing and then being baptized, because that's what Matthew 28 tells people to do. Okay. So thereafter, when he says, repent of this thy wickedness, this is just referring to his Christian life now.
But what the documentary did not explore in great detail are the people who preach and teach that we have to repent of sins or surrender our lives to Christ to be saved. Who are they? Why do they say that we have to repent of our sins and surrender our lives to Christ to be saved? And more importantly, do they practice what they preach? Have they repented of all of their own sins before telling you to repent of yours? These are the questions that will be explored in this sequel.
But woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye shut up the kingdom of heaven against men. For ye neither go in yourselves, neither suffer ye them that are entering to go in. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye devour widows' houses, and for a pretense make long prayer. Therefore ye shall receive the greater damnation. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye compass sea and land to make one proselyte, and when he is made, ye make him twofold more the child of hell than yourselves. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye make clean the outside of the cup and of the platter, but within they are full of extortion and excess. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye are like unto whited sepulchres, which indeed appear beautiful outward, but are within full of dead men's bones and of all uncleanness.
In his second letter to the Corinthian church, Paul feared for them that the serpent through his subtlety should corrupt their minds from the simplicity in Christ, saying, For if he that comes preaches another Jesus who we have not preached, or if you receive another spirit which you have not received, or another gospel which you have not accepted, you might, well, bear with him. The implications of this verse being that there is only one gospel. Paul defined what this gospel is and how to be saved by it in his previous letter to the same church, saying, Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I have preached unto you, by which also you have received and wherein you stand, by which also you are saved if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. If Paul solidified the strict definition of the gospel to them in the first letter, and yet in his second letter he was already fearing that they tolerated another gospel, we see how easily false gospels would enter into Christian churches. If Jesus' commandment in Mark 1:15 was to repent and believe the gospel, why are so many Christians telling you to repent of your sins and believe the gospel?
When they repent of their sin and believe the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Repent of your sins and believe the good news.
Did Jesus not explain repentance clearly enough in Mark 1:15? Doesn't the ending, believe the gospel, already explain what repentance means in this verse? If Jesus clearly explained what John the Baptist's repentance was in Matthew 21:32, that the chief priests didn't repent that they might believe him, as the publicans and harlots did, and Paul further qualified this in Acts 19:4 by explaining that the baptism of repentance was that they should believe on him, Christ Jesus, why are Christian preachers redefining John's repentance as turning from sins?
You know, when John the Baptist came on and he said, repent for the kingdom of God is at hand, he said, bring forth fruit. Bring forth works that are in accordance with repentance. He said, basically, turn away from sin.
And what does John the Baptist preach to us? Repent. Depart from your sinful ways.
Was Jesus mistaken in Matthew 21:32? Was Paul mistaken in Acts 19:4? If Jonah 3:10 makes it clear that turning from your wicked ways, which is synonymous with repent of your sins, is your works, and James qualified this by showing that it is a sin to not do works in James 4:17, saying, therefore to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. Why are Christian preachers saying that you must turn from your sins for salvation, and that it's by faith alone?
I don't know. I'd say repent and believe the gospel. Make sure that your faith is real. Contemplate your sin and the holiness of God and turn from your sin to Christ and cast yourself only on him.
And faith alone in Jesus Christ is preceded and followed by repentance, a turning away from sin.
It does not happen by works. We cannot earn our salvation. If we could earn our salvation, the cross of Christ is meaningless, empty, powerless, void. It happens when we turn from sins, repent, and place our trust in the finished work that he did for us on the cross.
But you know what doesn't make sense? Telling me that I have to turn from all my sins to be saved, and then turning around and telling me, oh, by the way, it's a free gift that Jesus did everything. Amen. It's like, wait, did Jesus do everything? Jesus did everything, but you got to make some serious change in your life. Well, did Jesus do everything or not? Is it free or not? Is it a gift or not? Is it faith alone or not?
If Jesus, throughout the four gospel accounts, never once uttered the word surrender, then why are phrases such as surrender your life to Christ a fundamental salvation instruction according to many Christians?
To be willing to forsake all. So there's some people who come to God and they want to be reborn. Now, being reborn is something God does once we fully surrendered. This is something that God does once we believed in him and chosen to surrender our life to him.
I want to lead you in a very simple prayer of surrendering your life to the Lord Jesus and allowing him.
Nor can you have saving faith without surrendering your life to the Lord Jesus Christ.
And this is essentially, this is the biggest false gospel out there, that you got to lay your life down, surrender your life, give your life to Jesus to be saved. It's such a wicked perversion of the good news of the gospel, because the good news of the gospel is that Jesus gave his life for you. Jesus spilled his precious blood on Calvary's cross, paying for all of your sins. This is what the devil says is, no, Jesus didn't die for you. You need to die to be saved. You need to give your life to Jesus to be saved.
Paul and Silas were asked one of the most important questions in Acts chapter 16, verse 30, that any man could ever ask. He, the prison keeper, brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" Paul and Silas, who had to answer the most important question in the history of man, responded with the most critical answer in the whole Bible, which was then so carefully recorded by the writer of the book of Acts. Paul and Silas said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house." The most important answer to the most important question in the whole Bible. I mean, come on, Paul, Silas, the writer of the book of Acts, couldn't you just tell us to repent of our sins, just so that there wouldn't be any confusion? The most important answer, you could have just said it or just written it down so that there would be no confusion about this topic. No mention of surrender your life to Jesus, no mention of repenting of your sins. It simply says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. It doesn't say they might be saved. It doesn't say they can be saved. It doesn't say you've taken the first step to a 12-step program to be saved. It says, whosoever believeth in him shall be saved.
So he's saying because he caught the Apostle Paul preaching the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus in a moment, without saying the words repent of sins, that's supposed to prove something. No, that's not the case. Take, for example, if I wear a t-shirt that says Jesus saves, I just preach the gospel. It doesn't have to say you need to repent of your sins. It doesn't have to say those who have faith in Jesus will repent of their sins. It's just a t-shirt that says Jesus saves. Okay, so no, I wouldn't accuse the Apostle Paul because he said Jesus saves, and he didn't at the same time say all the other details of the gospel and salvation at the same time that we're preaching a different message. I do the same thing. Okay, I tell people Jesus saves, and then I might catch my bus and not see them. Alright, so that's nonsensical.
Paul and Silas were not giving the prison keeper a super quick gospel presentation while they were boarding a bus. Immediately after verse 30, Paul and Silas spake unto him the word of the Lord and visited his house that night. They had every opportunity to tell the prison keeper to repent of his sins before he could be baptized. Even if they did, the Holy Spirit could have moved the writer of Acts to record that dialogue for us so that we would have such an essential instruction in the most important answer to the most important question in the Bible. When Jesus preached the gospel to Nicodemus in John chapter 3, he did not tell Nicodemus to repent of his sins or surrender his life. He only told Nicodemus to believe in him.
No, we need to believe on Jesus. We need to repent of our sins.
No one out here can tell me that you do not have to change. Your lifestyle has to change to something of the will of God for this to work for salvation.
Jesus was not briefly greeting him in the street. This was an opportune conversation. Jesus had every opportunity to warn Nicodemus to turn from his sins, if it was such a fundamentally urgent salvation instruction. John, in chapter 4 of his gospel account, only documented that the Samaritans believed on Jesus because of his own words. He never mentioned whether they repented of their sins or surrendered their lives.
Look, you need to repent of your sins, pal.
Many youth in the church doesn't really know who God is and has never really repented of their sins and has never really been born again because they don't know how to put their faith in Christ.
Surely, John could have stretched his writing on a little bit more paper if it was so fundamentally important to tell us that the Samaritans repented of their sins. When Jesus preached the gospel to the Jews in John chapter 6, he did not tell them to repent of their sins or surrender their lives. He only told them to believe on him.
The Bible says, unless you repent, you will perish. Unless you turn from your sin, you're going to burn in hell.
If you turn from your sin, if you leave the drunkenness, the sex outside of marriage, the pornography, all of that, you say, I'm leaving that behind, and follow after Jesus Christ, he promises to forgive you.
Jesus was not bullhorning passers-by in the street who would only get to hear 5 seconds of his speech. It was a detailed conversation. Jesus had every opportunity to tell them to turn from sin if it was so important to their eternal life. When Jesus preached the gospel to the Jews in John chapter 7, he did not tell them to repent of their sins or surrender their lives. He only told them to believe on him.
When you come to God, you leave your life of sin, you live your life pleasing to God. That is true repentance.
Once again, Jesus had ample opportunity to tell them to repent of their sins for salvation. When Jesus explained to the Pharisees in John chapter 8 that they would die in their sins, the reason given in verse 24 was because they did not believe. He did not say it was because they refused to clean up their lives. Most of the Pharisees had much cleaner lives than the publicans and sinners who did happily receive Jesus.
I stopped sinning. Have you stopped sinning? You better stop sinning.
Because I'm sitting here and I'm telling you that it's possible to be living a life where you no longer sin, where you no longer get sick.
When I repented of my sin, I changed my mind about living that way.
The I stands for you must have a testimony filled with I's, like I turned from my sins. I did the good works. The M stands for me. It's all about me.
When Jesus preached the gospel to the healed blind man in John chapter 9, he did not tell him to repent of his sins or surrender his life. He only told him to believe on him.
You don't get into heaven by faith alone.
When Jesus said to the Jews in John chapter 10 that they were not his sheep, the reason was because they did not believe. It wasn't because they did believe, but did not repent of their sins or surrender their lives. When Jesus did say, sin no more, twice in John's Gospel, he did not mention believing on him or eternal life in either of those two conversations. Eternal life and salvation had nothing to do with the phrase, sin no more.
Repent and be baptized. Sin no more.
If you have repented and you had true repentance, he is saying to you, sin no more.
When Jesus did say, deny yourself, take up your cross and follow me, he was explaining to his disciples about going to his death. None of his disciples went to the cross with him. They all forsook him. Jesus saved them anyway.
There is only one way you can be saved. You must surrender your life or the rest of your life. You must deny yourself because he's going to be the Lord of your life and not you.
When Jesus did say, repent and believe the gospel, repent for the kingdom of heaven is at hand, repent or you shall all likewise perish, notice that he left out the three magical, mystical words of your sins.
Some people will say that the exact phrase, repent of sins, isn't mentioned anywhere in the Bible. But this couldn't be further from the truth. I mean, yes, the exact wording, repent from sins, isn't found in Scripture.
If you believe that it is not enough to believe on Christ for eternal life, if you believe that turning from sin and surrendering your life are mandatory requirements for the gospel, you blaspheme Jesus by accusing him of preaching a false gospel to multiple people, multiple times, and you are in danger of the judgment.
It is not enough to simply believe in Christ. The demons tremble and believe.
How did Christianity drift so far from the simple words of Jesus to the Christianese jargon salad of today?
I want to lead you in a very simple prayer of surrendering your life to the Lord Jesus.
Without surrendering your life to the Lord Jesus Christ.
Have we surrendered everything to the Lord? We're still living partially for ourselves.
You must surrender your life or the rest of your life.
They've never really surrendered to the Lordship of Jesus in their life.
God does once we fully surrendered. This is something that God does once we've believed in him and chosen to surrender our life to him. He makes us new. He makes us reborn.
Surrendering to God means literally giving up your life in this world. Just
a really sweet surrender.
You can be a Christian for 50 years and never surrender your life to Jesus.
You do a particular act, it's because you've surrendered and you say to the Guru,
simply by surrendering to me completely, just by completely surrendering oneself to Sri Krishna, all the sinful reactions are destroyed and also the sinning propensity is destroyed.
Many Christians mistake the early church fathers as being closer to the truth than we are today. But Paul even warned the earliest churches about gospel perverts troubling them, even back then, saying, "I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you, and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed." Paul knew that it would only get worse after he would no longer be around to please the churches, saying, "For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock." During Paul's time, circumcision was perhaps the most common issue whereby men were trying to add works onto the gospel. Within the first few centuries after Paul's time, the ordinances of baptism and communion or Eucharist quickly became sacramental requirements, whereby works were appended to grace as a necessity for eternal life. The devil isn't just going to come out and say, "Trust works, everybody." Okay, he's going to sneak things in so that they seem like half they are a work, half they're not a work, so we're not really sure if it is a work or if it isn't a work. Now, in his first epistle, Peter quite clearly explained that it is the like figure whereunto baptism doth now save us. And just in case somebody says, "Well, the previous verse is the figure, but the baptism is what saves," well, he goes on to clarify just so that there's no confusion. It's not the putting away of the filth of the flesh when your flesh is dunked in the water, but the answer of a good conscience towards God when Christ saves you, when he removes your sin, and we have a clear conscience. And in fact, in Corinthians, Paul explains that Christ sent him to preach the gospel, not to baptize. Well, if baptism is such an important salvation instruction, he wasn't doing his job very well if he wasn't baptizing people. But Paul obviously didn't feel the need to baptize them when he was preaching the gospel. They could have had a baptism later. And as early as the 3rd century, men like Cyprian were starting to bring this in, where baptism is actually part of the salvific plan. It's something that we have to do to be saved. And well, it's not really works, you know, it's just how grace is dispensed. You know, it's not real work to just get yourself dunked in the water. It's not, you know, a big ask. So immediately, we're on this verge between something that isn't a work slowly becoming a work. Well, obviously it did become a work, because you fast forward a couple more hundred years and now people are baptizing babies, which is something that the Bible never commanded or taught, because they think that that's now doing something to save that child if that child happens to die at an early age. So now it's come right in, men trusting in their own actions and the things that they do instead of trusting on Jesus and what Jesus did. Starting with the first ecumenical council in Nicaea, 325 AD, congregations from all across Christendom committed harlotry with Roman politics by allowing the Emperor Constantine to assemble the council and preside over Christian church affairs. The formerly persecuted faith would amass for itself secular political power and funding for very nice buildings, and canon law would in time be forced on anyone and anything that declares itself Christian. The Catholic Church evolved. The Catholic Church would gradually introduce many other heresies and evil traditions, corrupting the simple gospel of salvation by grace without works that was delivered onto the first churches. Fusing elements of Christianity with pagan religions that it blended with, the Catholic Church developed its own Christianese style that is, in reality, completely foreign to anything described in the New Testament. Where in the New Testament do we see a pattern of God's people bowing down to and praying to statues of old saints? Was it not from pagans who would bow down to shrines and call upon the help of their ancestors? Where in the New Testament do we see a pattern of God's people singing to and bowing down to icons of Mary? Was it not from pagans who had feminine deities or ascribed feminine qualities to the nature of God? The successors to the Old Catholic Church, the Roman Catholic and Eastern Orthodox churches, continue the vain traditions and meaningless rituals of former times to this day.
Look, for those of you who didn't grow up Catholic, I brought a little demonstration for you, okay? I'm going to demonstrate this. But in order to give you the full feel, I have to dress up a little bit for this next part of the sermon. So, well, look, every magician puts on a robe and a funny hat. Just like every Catholic puts on a robe and a funny hat. All right, so my wife made me this hat this afternoon. She's very good with arts and crafts. All right, now, I've got the holy water here. And if those of you who've been Catholic, you know this is real what I'm about to do, okay? All right. Now don't worry, this is clean. This has never been used before, okay? So, all right. All right. Pax Vobiscum! Pax Vobiscum! All right, everybody. This is gonna keep the vampires and zombies away. All right, don't worry about zombies and all the different undead creatures, temptations. You won't be tempted anymore. The deliverance doctrine. All right. Pax Vobiscum. All right. Oh, that was a little too much. All right, everyone. Here you are. Here's your holy water. Be sure to cross yourselves regularly.
All right. Now you say, well, Pastor Anderson, you're being ridiculous. Yeah, this is no more stupid and ridiculous than what goes on in Roman Catholic churches. Every Sunday is not Christianity. It's not of the Bible. It's not of the New Testament. It's a bunch of hocus pocus today. It's crazy. And you say, well, that's just the sword of the Lord folded up into a funny hat. Well, you know what? It's no different than all these other funny hats and robes and weird outfits that they put on. And that toilet brush is no different than the little thing that they use to throw holy water around and everything like that. And what you've just been sprinkled with isn't going to keep the demons away any more or less than their so-called holy water. The whole thing's crazy. It's nonsense. And sorry to those of you in the back who did not receive a blessing.
Not only do the Roman Catholic and Eastern Orthodox churches have practices completely alien to churches described in the New Testament, they even have traditions and rules which deliberately disobey the teachings of Jesus and the Apostles.
Hi, my name is Father Mike Schmitz, and this is Ascension Presents. Actually, let's talk about that. Let's talk about, I didn't say hi, and this is Mike Schmitz. I said, hi, this is Father Mike Schmitz, and people were like, wait a minute, what the? Listen. I don't know the whole Bible, but I do know that Jesus said, call no man father, and yet here you are. We call our priests father, right? That's very interesting. We call the Pope the Holy Father.
I've had the experience of being in the congregation on the 31st Sunday in Ordinary Time, and the priest reads the words, call no man father, and we all get a little uncomfortable because we all call the priest himself father.
Now, it goes without saying that there are a lot of Catholic teachings that a lot of people think are contrary to what the Bible teaches. And one of those teachings that people believe are contrary to what the Bible teaches is the fact that Catholics have statues and Catholics will bow before the statues.
Are Catholics stupid or what? Catholics actually worship statues. Instead of worshiping God who's alive in heaven, they worship statues and like Mary and saints and stuff like that. I mean, how silly. Look at this thing. This statue, this isn't the real Jesus, you know. It's not the real Mary, you know. And this, St. Francis, he's not a real saint. It's a piece of wood.
And that comes up a lot when the question about why can't priests get married arises. Because a lot of times people bring me that question and they feel sorrow, they feel sadness. Like, Father, I wish that you could get married. And the reality of that is a priest being celibate, choosing not to get married for the sake of the kingdom of heaven, is not about a no to marriage, it's about a yes to what God has for us.
Why would the Catholic and Orthodox churches have rules and customs that deliberately disobey the Bible? Perhaps because believing that we are saved by grace through faith and not of works, they are grace abusers, using the free grace of God as a license to sin?
We are not saved by faith alone. It says you have to believe. It says you have to confess. It says you have to repent of your sins. It says you have to give your life to Christ. It says you have to be born again. It says you have to follow the commandments, do God's will, and be baptized. I mean, there are many things that we need to do from our end. And it's all Christ's work. It's all by the power of his cross, his grace, his victory, his smashing of sin and death, his victory over the devil and the gates of hell, all his work. But yet we must do something on our part. We must cooperate. We must say yes. We must give ourselves to Christ. That's not nothing. That's something we do on our part. It's a cooperation from our end.
The moral life is not an accessory to the faith. It's identical to it. That's why the Catechism says, the charity of Christ is the source in us of all our merits before God. Grace, by uniting us to Christ in active love, ensures the supernatural quality of our acts, and consequently their merit before God and men.
It is not enough to simply believe in Christ. The demons tremble and believe. Is this equivalent to holiness? Have we achieved illumination and deification by confessing what is?
So why then repent? Why struggle with our sins and our passions? Why fast? We do all of these things, these works, to overcome the barriers that we have placed between ourselves and God's grace. We're not starting at point zero and building up to goodness. We've already filled the space between ourselves and God with the passions, with sins, which we must repent of and overcome. Salvation is a free gift, but we must work and repent in order to enable ourselves to receive God's grace.
He calls it in Romans the obedience of faith. And the obedience of faith is this. It's not just, I believe in God intellectually. I know that he exists. It's a deeper, where it's, that's actually touched not just my intellect, it's touched my will. It doesn't just touch what I believe, it touches how I act, that I choose to obey the Lord. And that the bridge between this intellectual assent and the willful obedience is this five-letter word called trust.
One is justified, that is, included into the community of God, but also must continue through a process of sanctification, cooperating with the grace of God to allow God to flourish in us. It is not enough to passively allow grace to declare us justified. We must actively take up the task of growing in righteousness.
Jesus Christ himself, who says, if a man keeps not my commandments, works sprung from love, he is cast forth as a branch and withers.
These are but a few well-known Catholic and Orthodox representatives, if we assume their views accurately reflect that of their churches. Then the Catholic and Orthodox position is unanimously clear. Faith must produce works of obedience if it is a genuine faith leading to the salvation of your soul. Unlike their Protestant and Evangelical counterparts, they are very upfront and honest about their works-based salvation. They do not make any pretenses masquerading as faith alone. But if they are so certain and so serious about their claim that true faith must produce works of obedience, why do they have the appearance of willfully, knowingly, and deliberately doing works of disobedience by having traditions, practices, and rules that defy the holy words of the Bible?
Now, first of all, let's get some definitions of hypocrisy from this chapter. And there are several definitions that we can find right here in the chapter. But first of all, in verse 3, the Bible says, all therefore whatsoever they bid you observe, that observe and do, but do not ye after their works. And then here's the key, for they say and do not. So the number one definition of a hypocrite here is someone who says one thing and does another. They say and do not. For example, this would be somebody who tells you that you need to be reading your Bible every day and then they're not reading the Bible. Or they tell you, hey, we need to be out soul winning. We need to be getting people saved. We need to preach the gospel to every creature. But they're not actually out doing that work themselves. They tell you to do a lot of good deeds and good works, but they don't participate in it themselves. Look what the Bible says in verse 5, but all their works they do for to be seen of men. They make broad their phylacteries and enlarge the borders of their garments and love the uppermost rooms at feasts and the chief seats in the synagogues and greetings in the markets and to be called of men, Rabbi, Rabbi. Now elsewhere, when Jesus is making a very similar speech to this in the book of Luke, he talks about how they love to go in long clothing. That's the term he uses. Here he talks about them enlarging the borders of their garments, but in Luke it's worded as going in long clothing. And you'll notice how many religious leaders and clerics of our day will go around in long clothing, don't they? They basically will walk through the airport or wherever you see them in long flowing garments, and they have these gowns on that really look ridiculous if you think about it. They're not really practical clothing.
But you see Catholic priests in that kind of a garment. You see the Orthodox priests in that kind of a garment. You see Jews wearing those kind of garments sometimes. You'll see Muslim imams in these long, flowing garments. What's the purpose of wearing that kind of clothes? There's only one purpose: to put on a show to the people around you. Hey, everybody, look at me. I'm a holy man. I'm a man of God. And putting on a robe and tying it with a weird hood or something, looking like, you know, you're from Star Wars or something. Basically, the point is just so everybody sees you and says, there's a guy who is just a really spiritual leader, and that's why they turn around the collar backwards and put on the funny hat. It's all to be seen of man, and Jesus is warning against this. And then it says they love these titles. And these are the type of titles that they love: Rabbi. And then here's another title they like: Father. Because look what the Bible says in verse number 9. And call no man your father upon the earth, for one is your Father which is in heaven. Neither be ye called masters, for one is your master, even Christ.
We can't just quote mine verses and accuse Catholics and Orthodox of disobeying Scripture. Otherwise, we could accuse anybody of anything. We need to allow them to answer for themselves.
Are we going against Jesus' word? Because Jesus said, call no man on earth Father. Matthew 23. First thing I want to say is, if we're ever tempted to dismiss the words of Jesus, we're going down the wrong road, right? If we're ever tempted to say, well, I know the Bible says this, but that is the wrong road to go down. So we never, ever, 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 ever dismiss the words of Jesus. Ever. But we do need to understand the context, as well as how did the people receive it? How did they understand it?
Mike Schmitz initially proposes a valid argument. We need to understand the context of the verse so that we are not dismissing the words of Jesus. So then, what is the context?
What's the context? Jesus in Matthew 23 is saying, he's talking about those who want to lord it over others. So that he says, here's the rabbis. Ah, man, they're trying to be in charge and trying to basically draw attention to themselves. So don't be called rabbi. Don't like seek that kind of fame. Don't seek that kind of influence. Don't seek power. So Father, like that same kind of thing. Like, listen, that belongs to the Father in heaven. When it comes to, you know, as I said, teacher, that's rabbi means, don't be called teacher. Now, the context again is Jesus is warning against, he's warning the apostles against seeking that authority, seeking that influence, seeking the power for its own sake, not power to be able to serve.
Having only just said that we need to look at the context, Mike Schmitz has immediately changed the context in his explanation. The word hypocrite is mentioned 7 times in Matthew 23. The context of this passage is about hypocrites. In the original video these clips were sourced from, Mike Schmitz never once mentioned hypocrisy as being the context. The lording it over others context does not come from Matthew 23. It actually comes from Matthew 20:25 in a completely separate discourse and its parallel passage in Mark 10:42, referring to the rulers of the Gentiles, not Jewish rabbis. Lording it over others is not the context of Matthew 23. Mike Schmitz has swapped the context of Matthew 23, hypocrite, with that of a completely different passage. Mike Schmitz is not simply an average unlearned Catholic who is innocently asking questions. He is a well-studied and respected Catholic theologian and influential leader. And he has knowingly, willingly, and intentionally bore false claims about the context of Matthew 23 to justify his blatant disregard and contempt for the important warnings of Jesus against religious leaders while wearing a cloak of fake humility. Now, why would somebody change the context? Well, a hypocrite doesn't like passages about hypocrites, so he's got to make that passage say something else when it testifies against him.
What's the context? Jesus in Matthew 23 is saying, he's talking about those who want to lord it over others. So that he says, here's the rabbis. Ah, man, they're trying to be in charge. It doesn't just touch what I believe, it touches how I act, that I choose to obey the Lord.
So this is you here, and this is the priest. Now, we have direct communication with God. I'm sorry if you don't know this, you've never heard this before, but the Bible says, call no man upon earth Father. Okay? So what do Catholics do? They call this guy Father, right? Call no man upon earth Father. Why? Because we have direct communication as saved, sealed believers with God. We don't need a mediatrix or a mediator through man. That wicked sinner who very possibly may be in touching young boys or not, I don't know. We don't need to go to him to confess our sins, okay? We go straight to the Father.
Pastor, teacher, bishop, elder, deacon, these are good terms. Master, rabbi, father are blasphemous terms. Any questions?
Protestants say that you can't call man father. They say that passage is literal, and Catholics don't think that it is because from beginning to end of the New Testament, men are called father. Jesus calls men father. Paul calls men father. Stephen calls men father. James, Luke, Peter, all of them call men father from the beginning to the end of the New Testament. Even Jesus says, honor your father and mother, and a man shall leave his father and mother and cling to his wife.
Okay, so it's immediately obvious what he's doing here. He's strawmanning the issue, because I've never heard Protestants complain about ever using the word father to refer to a man ever. I've never heard that complaint. The issue is calling your priest father when naming him or addressing him. That's the problem. You see, it's not a problem that you can describe men as fathers, or you can, you know, refer to people that they've been your father. That's not the issue. The issue is addressing somebody as father, either in front of or in place of their name when you address them. That's the problem.
Last time I checked, Abraham was, in fact, a man, and several people throughout the Bible are calling him father and referring to him as a spiritual father.
So in order to manipulate Catholics, what he's essentially doing here is he's confusing two different things as if they are equivalent to the same thing. So because the Bible frequently refers to Abraham as father, and it does in plenty of places, that means you can then call your priest father when addressing, like, Father so-and-so. Oh, hello, Father. Oh, thank you, Father. But that's just simply not true. In the New Testament, people weren't talking directly to Abraham. They were referring back to him. And so they weren't calling him father. They were describing him as a father. That's not the same thing as constantly calling him Father Abraham or Father Father when addressing him. And all you have to do is just work your way down the concordance in the New Testament, and you can see example after example after example after example of where it's Abraham, 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 without putting father in front of it like that's part of his name or that's his title of address or something. In the Gospels, one person who did refer to Father Abraham when actually addressing Abraham is the rich man in Luke 16 who's burning in hell. But you see, you wouldn't get that from Brian Mercy because it's not really convenient for his doctrine.
Even though it says call no man father, apparently we can call some men father, like earthly fathers. And they say just not spiritual fathers. But the reality is the Bible calls men father in a spiritual way as well. And in fact, in Acts 7, 1 and 2, Stephen calls not only Abraham our spiritual father, but he addresses the elders in Jerusalem, the living body of Jerusalem, fathers. So he calls men father, and he calls Abraham father in a spiritual sense, both in a spiritual sense.
Well, now he's just bearing false witness and spreading misinformation. First of all, when he calls this group fathers, he's addressing a crowd of people. This is not the same thing as addressing a personal individual as father in place of his name or as some kind of honorary title. It's not the same thing. And many of these people probably were fathers that he was talking to, like men, brethren, fathers, just different kinds of relationships that he's describing them as. And when it says our father Abraham, when Stephen says that, he goes on to talk about how Abraham begat so-and-so, and these are our fathers, because they're physical descendants of these people. There's no evidence that this has anything to do with spiritual fatherhood. He's making up shit to promote his false religion.
And in fact, Paul says the same thing in 1 Corinthians 4:15. He says that I have become your father in the gospel. Not just your father, you know, and I had you as children, but no, in the gospel, meaning it's a spiritual fatherhood.
Now, again, this has got nothing to do with the issue being discussed. It's a complete straw man. Yes, Paul may have described himself as a father to those people and considered himself a father, but he didn't go around calling himself Father Paul, Father Paul, Father Paul, and people didn't address him as Father Paul. Well, how do I know that? Well, you just look down the concordance, look at the name Paul, and you just see in every single instance, it's Paul, 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 Paul. There's no mention of Father. And if you just search for the word Father in all of these verses, it yields no results because the word Father is never coupled with his name Paul in any of these verses. So Paul describing himself as a father has got nothing to do with calling somebody Father as a title or as a name. They're not connected. So what he's basically doing here is the guy that tells you that you have to have works of obedience for heaven and you must do this and you must do that and you need to clean up your life and you need to turn from your sins and give your life to Christ, he has excuses for his disobedience. You see, it's alright for him to disobey the Bible because he can, you can't. You've got to turn from your sins, but he's got special exemptions and excuses for his disobedience. And that's what these false prophets and these hypocrites are like. Now let's just say that even the good men of God did address people as Father in the Bible. The fact that Jesus said, and referring to spiritual titles that we give to men here, call no man on earth your father, you know, and not like rabbi and master and things like that, wouldn't, just to be safe, just to play the safe side, would it not be better to just find a different title to call your priest? Call him reverend, call him priest so-and-so, or, you know, call him pastor so-and-so, or bishop so-and-so. Give him any other title, just not the specific titles that Jesus said no. Well, not according to Brian Mercier, because someone made a statement on his video here saying that, well, I am a Catholic, but we shall not call priests fathers. So, you know, even he's thinking, you know, just to be on the safe side, I'm not going to do this. And then he just gets this reply, well, you say that you're Catholic, and yet this is not what the Catholic Church teaches. Well, here we go then. The Catholic Church is deliberately teaching you to disobey the Bible. They're not even offering any alternatives for your good conscience. Oh, okay, in good conscience you don't want to call him Father, well, we'll give you an alternative then. None of that. No, you have to do it. You have to disobey the Bible to follow our filthy, wicked, harlot religion. Is Brian Mercier deliberately manipulative, or is he incredibly stupid while wearing a disguise as an intelligent apologist? Is it possible that being unsaved, he is simply the blind leading the blind?
John 3:5 says you must be born again in order to get to the kingdom of heaven. And in fact, being born again means being baptized. So you have to be baptized in order to get to heaven. And Jesus saves us through baptism, which is why Mark 16:16 says he who believes and is baptized will be saved.
In this clip, Brian Mercier has misinterpreted the meaning of born of water in John 3 as referring to baptism. He has therefore associated baptism with birth.
And it's also why 1 Peter 3:21 says that baptism now saves you, because it's part of the salvation process and it's how we are born again. In fact, Romans chapter 6 says that we are buried with Christ in his death. And unless we are buried with Christ in his death, we will not be resurrected with him in the afterlife. How are we buried with him? Romans 6 says it's through baptism.
Only moments later, in the same video, he has then confirmed from Romans 6 that we are buried with Christ in baptism unto his death. Is he really a well-studied apologist, and yet he can't even understand something as basic as the difference between birth and death? If he can't even discern the difference between birth and death, ought we to listen to him tell us something as important as the right way to make it to heaven? The alternative explanation is that Brian Mercier is indeed not stupid, but rather he is deliberately and slyly manipulative by holding contradictory standards of righteousness in order to willfully and knowingly deceive his listeners. Just like his father, the cunning serpent who deceived Eve in the garden.
We are not saved by faith alone. That is a man-made doctrine that was invented centuries and centuries after Jesus existed. No early Christian taught that. Can anyone out there who believes in Jesus plus nothing equals salvation, can you find that phrase for me in Scripture? Can you find me where it says Jesus plus nothing equals salvation? It's not there. It's not even hinted there.
Jesus plus nothing equals salvation is a Christianese catchphrase that is often used by faith alone advocates. It is used as a summation and simplification of what the Bible says, but it is not a phrase that is ever found in the Bible. For this reason, Brian Mercier is dismissing the phrase, saying that it is not true because you cannot point to this phrase in the Bible. But when we listen to his gospel presentation, we see very quickly how two-faced and hypocritical he really is.
There's something that we have to do from our end. In other words, we have to choose to give our lives to Christ.
Nowhere in the Bible does it say we have to choose to give our lives to Christ. It actually says that we were dead in our trespasses, Christ laid his life down for us and raised us up to new life.
We have to choose to cooperate with his grace.
Nowhere does the Bible say we have to choose to cooperate with his grace. On the contrary, Ephesians 1:4-7 explains that according to his grace, he chose us in him before the foundation of the world.
It says you have to repent of your sins.
All of the verses about repentance that are relevant to salvation, such as Matthew 3:2, Mark 1:15, Acts 2:38, and Acts 3:19, never add the suffix of your sins. Turning from a sinful lifestyle is not the context of repentance in those verses.
And in fact, that's why in James 2:24 it says we are not saved by faith alone.
James 2:24 does not say that we are saved by faith and works. It actually says we are justified by faith and works.
There's places all over the Bible says we're saved by faith apart from works, and it's always works of the law. The old covenant of the Jews, their rituals, their cleansings, and all those Old Testament works, yeah, we're not saved by those. But Christ commands us in Ephesians 2:10, he ordained us to do good works, meaning we have to do good works.
If Ephesians 2:10 means that we have to do works, but not works of the law, but we are not saved by works of the law, then verse 10 directly contradicts preceding verses 8-9, which explicitly state that we are not saved by works. Between verses 9 and 10, no distinction is made between works of the law and salvific works. He is willfully manipulating his listeners by changing the definition of works between verses 9 and 10, but there is nothing in those verses indicating that the definition of works has suddenly changed. This deception is a common trick not just by Catholics, but by all the workers of iniquity.
They're scum. They're absolute scum. They're not just unsaved, they're scum.
Certain people are trash, and they're going to be permanently thrown away into the biggest trash can there is that's called hell. Amen. Hell is the ultimate trash receptacle.
Can anyone out there who believes in Jesus plus nothing equals salvation, can you find that phrase for me in Scripture? There's something that we have to do from our end. In other words, we have to choose to give our lives to Christ.
Works do not make us good. We do not achieve goodness through anything we can do. So why then repent? Why struggle with our sins and our passions? Why fast? We do all of these things, these works, to overcome the barriers that we have placed between ourselves and God's grace. We're not starting at point zero and building up to goodness. We've already filled the space between ourselves and God with the passions, with sins, which we must repent of and overcome.
There are some disobediences where the Roman Catholic Church is undoubtedly far more guilty and hypocritical than the Eastern Orthodox Church. But there are some disobediences where the Eastern Orthodox Church is far worse than the Roman Catholic Church. In Spyridon's case, and like many other Orthodox clergy, he has long hair when Paul explicitly stated in the first book of Corinthians that it is a shame unto Christ for a man to have long hair. If we have to do these works to overcome the barriers between ourselves and God, why then do so many devout Orthodox followers bring shame onto Christ in this way?
So I went on the internet, I started looking at this thing of why do Orthodox priests often have long hair, right? Now, when I've been out soul winning with a friend of mine who knows the Bible very well, we obviously encounter a lot of Christians that don't really know very much about the Bible at all, understandably. And sometimes we refer to them, jokingly, as Christians who don't know a Nazarite from a Nazarene. Now, I thought I was just joking. It turns out, scarily enough, this is actually true. So I've found multiple articles here where you go down to what their explanation is. So in this first one, and this is on stjohnchurch.org, you scroll down and it introduces the fact that they have long hair to emulate Christ, who was a Nazarene. Okay, now pay attention to that right there. It then goes on to say that this is a law given to the Nazarene, but then it starts the title saying the Nazarite vow. So it's conflated Jesus being a Nazarene with the Nazarite vow. Those two things have got nothing to do with each other. Jesus was a Nazarene because he came from a town called Nazareth. The Nazarite vow refers to the people that did this vow. And this wasn't the only article that I found doing this. Here's another one, orthodoxinfo.com. Now, I don't know how authoritative this is amongst Orthodox people, but it does look fairly authoritative, doesn't it, calling itself the Orthodox Christian Information Center. Well, I find this, concerning the tradition of long hair, you scroll down, and it says the significance of the Nazarene vow. It wasn't a Nazarene vow, it was the Nazarite vow. And this comes from, I guess it's from this person named here, Ecumen Luke, or however you pronounce his name, from the book From Orthodox Life. Okay, well, quotes from this article are basically just being copied and repeated on multiple sites that deal with the same question. So, yet, here's another one. It's just copying the same thing. The outward appearance as a commandment was repeated in the law given to the Nazarene. It wasn't given to the Nazarene. It was given to the Nazarite. You see, Nazarene comes from a Greek word, and it's Nazarenos or Nazareos, which is referring to people who came from the town of Nazareth. Nazarite comes from a Hebrew word, Nazir. So one's coming from a Greek word, one's coming from a Hebrew word. And people will say, well, Nazareth just kind of sounds like a Nazarite. Yeah, well, you know, in English we have a carrot and a parrot and they both have orange on them. That doesn't mean that the two things are related. And the Orthodox Church wants to tell you that they're the original church that Christ founded and you need their authority to be able to understand the Bible. They can't even tell the difference between a Nazarite and a Nazarene, and you want these people to tell you how to get to heaven when you die? And why is it we have to refer to all of these cryptic Old Testament passages that we don't really fully understand anyway, and override the clear teaching to the New Testament church? Why not just, if you're going to tell us that I have to work my way to heaven and obey my way to heaven, and I have to turn from my sins, well, why don't you just go with what Paul said and just cut your hair, like Corinthians told you to, and stop trying to use obscure things from the Old Testament to cancel out clear New Testament church teaching? And look, please don't misunderstand me, I'm not attacking every man that happens to watch this and has long hair. But if you are going to have long hair, don't tell the rest of us we have to turn from our sins and obey our way to heaven, okay? Either have long hair and believe in grace or keep silent.
These hypocrisies barely scratch the surface of just how wicked the Catholic and Orthodox churches have been in times past, especially the Roman Catholic Church. Catholic apologists whine like toddlers and complain about what a terrible move in history the Reformation was, when it was precisely the wicked, evil behaviour of the Roman Catholic Church that fueled the flames of the Reformation in the first place. When they killed and tortured countless numbers of people without evidence as part of their false Inquisition. Catholics today still make excuses for this abominable behaviour and try to downplay the number of victims. When they killed people for trying to read the Bible in their own languages, and yet they insist that they gave you the Bible. When they oppressed the poor by taking their money for indulgences, manipulating them into believing that by donating their money, they will escape a non-existent place called purgatory. And yet these disgusting reprobates tell you to obey your way to heaven. The list of their victims is endless.
It is the most hair-raising, evil, satanic, just disgusting actions that people have committed in the history of mankind. The barbarity, the cruelty, the sadistic wickedness of the Roman Catholic Church is just beyond comprehension. And yet people today think this is a godly religion. And even Baptists will sometimes say, oh, well, you know, there are a lot of Catholics that are Christian and, you know, they're still Christian. They're just off on a few things or blah, blah, blah. I've been in a Baptist church where the Sunday school teacher literally said that the church was really corrupt around the time of the Reformation to the point where many of the popes weren't even saved. And my mom, she felt compelled to stand up and say, are you saying that there ever was a pope that was saved? And he said, I think the pope we have right now, we have. He said, I think the pope we have right now is saved, referring to John Paul II, who's roasting in hell right now. John Paul is in hell!
Yeah.
Oh, how dare you say it? He's right there with Mother Teresa.
Yeah.
And you know what? You say, well, I'm offended, I'm leaving. Well, then go back to the mother whore Catholic Church.
Yeah.
That's drunken with the blood of the saints and drunken with the martyrs of Jesus. that has murdered and killed and tortured true believers and heretics and Jews and everybody else. Yeah, all the blood that's shed on the earth of all kinds of people, but including biblical Christians. And you have the gall to get offended when I tell you that the leader of this cult is in hell today. He's burning. Oh, those who were burned at the stake, they may have only suffered for a few minutes or a few hours. But John Paul will roast in hell for all eternity with every last Catholic pope before him, all of them. Yeah. Every bishop of that damnable, wicked Church of Rome is in hell, in the lowest hell, and will be for all eternity. Yeah. And we need some preaching against the Roman Catholic Church today. Yeah. You know, it's wicked. They're murderous, hands dripping with blood. Dark places filled with pedophilia and sick filth of homosexuality. These monasteries are like a queer bathhouse. And somebody needs to point out this horrible dragging of the name of our Savior in the mud for the last 2,000 years. Making excuses for it. Acting like it's not that bad. It's wicked. It's nothing to do with Christianity. It's a pagan, hocus-pocus, chanting, work your way to heaven, build us a tower that we may reach unto heaven religion. I have nothing to do with anything of that harlot, the Roman Catholic Church. Filthier than any literal whore who has ever walked down the streets of a downtown area. You say, well, you hate Catholics. No, I don't. But I hate the Pope, and I hate the Catholic Church. And may they all rot in hell who have created this wicked religion. Yeah. But the Catholics I don't hate. I love the Catholics, which is why I'm telling them the truth about the satanic minister who's trying to lead them to hell with his pagan hocus pocus and superstition. You see, if you love Catholics, you'll tell them the truth that there's no salvation inside the Catholic Church. Catholics love to tell you there's no salvation outside of the Catholic Church. No, there is no salvation inside the Catholic Church. None. If you want to go to heaven, you must reject the Roman Catholic Church. And if you believe in the Roman Catholic Church, you will split hell wide open, period. That rosary chanting and Hail Mary is going to send you to hell. There is no mediator between God and men but the man Christ Jesus.
So stop praying to statues and get your soul saved today. My name is Brian Mercier. I'm a Catholic, and I do not endorse that message.
Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Recognizing the wickedness, hypocrisy, and unbiblical nonsense of Catholicism, Martin Luther triggered what would become known as the Reformation. Various reformers such as John Calvin, Jacobus Arminius, and many others would be influential in the progress of the Reformation movement. Failing to reform the Roman Catholic Church itself, the Reformation movement led to various Protestant breakaway denominations. These denominations did not fully agree on all the specifics, such as Calvin's emphasis on predestination and Arminius' emphasis on free will. But Protestantism was broadly and loosely united around the five solas. Sola Scriptura, by Scripture alone. Sola Fide, by faith alone. Sola Gratia, by grace alone. Solo Christo, through Christ alone. And Soli Deo Gloria, glory to God alone. But do they really believe in these solas?
By grace alone, through faith alone, to God alone be the glory. Right? It all sounds great. So I like that. I like all this. Here's the problem with the Protestants. They don't take their own advice here. Because if they actually believed these five things, then it'd be great. The problem is that they don't take their own advice. They didn't go far enough in their Reformation, and so they still retain a lot of the false doctrine and traditions of the Roman Catholic Church, and that's the problem.
I often hear the claim that true biblical Christianity presents a simple way to be saved, whereas Catholicism makes salvation overly complicated. So under Protestantism, and the majority of Protestants are evangelicals, all you have to do to be saved is simply accept Christ as your Lord and Savior. Catholics, on the other hand, distort the gospel, allegedly, with all these other requirements or works in order to be saved, like being baptized, receiving the Eucharist, avoiding mortal sin, going to confession. But here's the thing. Almost all Protestants have a bunch of requirements to be saved beyond just accepting Jesus as their Lord and Savior. What they do is the equivalent of the iTunes terms and conditions. They add a bunch of small print of all the things you need to do in order to get to heaven after you click on the agreement to make Christ your Lord and Savior. But the way they do this is by saying good works are not required to be saved, they're just proof that you are saved. Okay, but it sure feels like that if I don't do these good works, then there's no proof I'm saved, which practically means I'm not saved. So the works are something I have to do to be saved.
I think most Protestants who enthusiastically champion sola scriptura are doing it from piety. What they're trying to say is that these words are from God and we trust them 100%. That is, in fact, not what sola scriptura means.
So Martin Luther's 95 Theses is the famous document where he attacked a lot of things in the Catholic Church and the papacy, particularly around confessional booths and indulgences and penance and things like that. So he opens up this letter to talk about the meaning of repentance. Okay, and what he says in the second point is very important, is that this word cannot be understood as referring to the sacrament of penance. Now, the Catholic Bibles at the time were deliberately mistranslating the word repent as do penance. So that's how the Catholic Church was defining it, and so they deliberately changed their Bibles to mistranslate that word. And so he's refuting that false interpretation. But then he goes on to say that it does not mean solely inner repentance, that inner repentance is worthless unless it produces various outward mortification of the flesh. And so you see how his definition of repentance wasn't really that different from Catholicism, except that he just stripped some of the mundane rituals out of it, but it still required this transformation of character, this self-reformation. So when you define repentance as outward mortification of the flesh, that right there is not faith alone language, that is works language. Okay, now it's not work in the same way as going out and doing something, like, you know, going out and giving alms, or going out and preaching the gospel, or going out and giving the poor, but it's still our obedience, it's our righteousness, it's our works.
The Lutherans have two sacraments, whereas the Roman Catholics have seven sacraments, okay? So again, you see that the Reformers, they're getting rid of some unscriptural things, but then they're still keeping some wrong things around. They didn't go far enough. They didn't get rid of enough of the vain tradition. What's the average Lutheran tell you? Live a good life, be a good person. I mean, that's not what Martin Luther taught. But they'll say, oh, you gotta go to church, stop sinning, live a good life, be a good person, at least try. Or they'll say you got to confess your sins every day, and if you die in a state of unconfessed sin, you'll go to hell. So it's like you have to keep, you know, so if when that car's coming at you at 70 miles an hour, you better just confess everything fast. Like, Lord, I'm sorry for what I did 30 seconds ago. Oh, yes, I made it in.
What do Anglicans believe? If you go on the Anglican Communion website, this is what they believe. Anglicans believe that people become members of God's church through baptism. I was looking on the Church of England website just for a clear statement of faith, and it's actually pretty hidden. So let me tell you where it was. So they have a section, what we believe. You'd think you'd find it there, wouldn't you? But you have to go in that section of 11 subsections to somewhere called the Pilgrim's Way, and then one of five subsections in the Pilgrim's Way called the Apostles' Creed to finally find this. To believe is to trust in the Father's love for the world and the saving work of Jesus Christ on the cross and in the transforming power of the Holy Spirit. How do you become a Christian? By turning to Jesus Christ in faith. By repenting of your sin. And being baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit. What is sin? Sin means not living according to the will of God. Sin is to fall short in our thoughts, words, and deeds through what we do and through what we fail to do. Sin separates us from God and neighbor. What is baptism? Baptism in water is a sacrament of new birth in Christ. We die to sin that we may live his risen life. We are washed by the Holy Spirit and become members of the church. What's the hope that's in them? I'm assuming the hope is that they've repented of their sins enough that the baptism saved them and that they've turned to Jesus Christ in faith. Now, That's pretty different, isn't it, to what we know the Bible says. It's pretty different to Acts 16:30, sirs, what must I do to be saved? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, thou shalt be saved in thy house. It's a long way away from that, is it? Getting baptized, repenting of your sins, following Jesus and the rest of it. Now, we should get baptized, shouldn't we? But it's not required for salvation. I don't remember the thief on the cross fitting in a quick dip. Anyone remember that? Quick dip with the thief on the cross? Maybe they, I don't know what they would claim. Maybe someone dunked him, or maybe it's just a bit of a sprinkle. Maybe it's a bit of a sprinkle, I don't know. You know, it's one of those where they're a bit shifty, because they'll say, oh yeah, it's faith in Jesus, but it obviously needs closer inspection, doesn't it? And as you see with that Anglican one, that was pretty shifty, wasn't it? They try to just be a bit hazy with how they explain it.
If the Church of England is so sure that true repentance for salvation includes the turning from sin, we ought to look at Anglicanism as a very godly and righteous denomination, correct?
Apparently, this is what we've got here. A total of 570 deacons were ordained in 2019. They become deacons before they become priests in the Church of England Church. False church. With women making up 51% of the new intake. 51% now. So there is now more women than men. That women made up around 32% of the 20,000 active clergy last year, with a growing proportion of senior posts such as bishops, archdeacons and cathedral deans growing from 25% in 2018 to 27% last year. Don't forget that verse, but I suffer not a woman to teach nor to usurp authority over the man but to be in silence. We're not just going priests, we're going much higher up now. Okay, it's wicked, isn't it? It's absolutely wicked. Nowadays, they're very often open sodomites. Open sodomites. I was talking to a brother actually a while back who was telling me about someone, a family member who was sadly training for this. 20 of them were just open sodomites. I mean, what on earth? Yet they're calling themselves father, okay? But again, they, you know, sodomites can have kids.
Whereas the Roman Catholic and Eastern Orthodox churches treat repentance like dispensing coins in a vending machine, dispensing enough grace to hopefully enter heaven, their Protestant counterparts, and much of evangelicalism today, treats repentance as a retrospective assessment of one's own life to examine whether you really did believe enough to get into heaven. Although evangelicals will differ on the finer details, this is broadly referred to by critics as Lordship salvation. The general idea is that you are saved by faith alone, but true, saving faith will produce works. It carries with it Christianese jargon such as surrender to the Lordship of Christ or make Jesus the Lord of your life.
God, I think that Christians read back in an Acts-based version of their own lives through a variety of mechanisms, whether they say, well, predestination exists, but in order to show that if I were really elect, I would be acting this way, right? That is an Acts-based version. It's just retroactive from the end. Mm-hmm. And so this is why if you say to a Christian, so you really believe that you can lead a terribly dissolute, awful, terrible life, but if you believe in Christ with the full fiber of your being, you're going to heaven? And they'll say, many of them will say, yes, but then you say, but what makes a good person? And they'll say, right, not, but if, and right, what they'll exactly. Always add, but if you believe in Christ, you wouldn't do all those things. Mm-hmm.
Many proponents of Lordship salvation assert that while salvation is by faith alone, saving faith is never alone. Genuine faith, real faith is never alone. Implying that works are an inevitable result of genuine belief in Christ, and if your faith is not accompanied by this unquantified amount of action and obedience, well, then I guess you're just not really saved.
The biblical view is that we are saved through faith alone. That's the instrument that joins us to Jesus, right? But saving faith is never alone. It always has works. If it is truly saving faith, it will produce works because it's a divine faith given by God that's real.
Here's what they say. Well, yeah, we have to repent of our sins to be saved and clean up our life and do good works and live a good life. But it's God who gave us the grace to give us the ability to do the works. Folks, this is just a repackaging of works salvation. You have to do the works, but God's the one who gave you the ability to do the works, so therefore it's not works salvation, it's grace. Wrong is faith alone salvation, friend.
The question they asked was, how do you get into heaven? You don't get into heaven by faith alone. You get justified by faith alone. You get into a position where God is 100% for you by faith alone. And in order to get into heaven, that faith must bear the fruit of love. Pursue the holiness without which you will not see the Lord. Put to death the deeds of the body and you will live.
This is a backloaded works salvation, or as Ben Shapiro so aptly stated, a retroactive acts-based version of salvation. And what this boils down to is this is just a roundabout way of introducing and incorporating works into the gospel, attempting to sneak works through the back door. How many works are necessary to prove the validity of one's conversion? How much change? How obedient is obedient enough? Think about that. And what you'll often find is that the proponents of this false teaching are the ones setting forth this subjective standard whereby we determine whether or not we have genuine faith.
Assuming the premise that true faith must produce works of obedience, it is inevitable that repenting of your sins has become a fundamental part of their gospel message. Though they inherited the principles of it from Catholicism, Evangelicalism has widely popularized the actual catchphrase. Unlike their Catholic cousins of Cain, they do not have the decency to openly admit that works are a component of the gospel of salvation. They will tell you that we are saved by faith alone, because it's all by what Jesus did, but then they still tell you that you must turn from your sins, you must surrender your life, you must make Jesus the Lord of your life.
It does not happen by works. We cannot earn our salvation. If we could earn our salvation, the cross of Christ is meaningless, empty, powerless, void. It happens when we turn from sins, repent, and place our trust in the finished work that He did for us on the cross.
You cannot do a single good deed, a single right act that makes you acceptable to God. But nor can you have faith without works. Nor can you have faith without obedience. Nor can you have saving faith without surrendering your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I'm not preaching Lordship salvation.
What can we say of those who are preaching this message? Have they surrendered their lives to the Lordship of Christ? Have they had genuine repentance for their sins?
What is repentance? Repentance is that sinner forsakes his sin, that the sinner forsakes his sin, puts it out of his thoughts, and fully resolves in his mind that he will never do it again. What he's saying is there ought to be a change in your lifestyle. Stop doing what you used to do. Do righteous things, not unrighteous things. Be loving and sharing and kind. He says to the Pharisees and the Sadducees, if you've got two coats, give one to somebody. And if you've got food, give it to somebody who's hungry. Let me see something in your life. It's exactly what James says. Faith without works is what? Dead. You'll never prove true repentance unless the fruit of repentance and the work of repentance is visible.
Faith without works is dead. You guys don't even understand that because you're not saved and you're in darkness. So you will find these obscure verses that have nothing to do with eternal salvation, and you'll twist them to be about a works-based gospel.
You know, they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. See, what John MacArthur is doing is he's making this so utterly confusing that you're like, well, he's got the PhD and the fancy suit and he's got grace in the name of his church and he seems like he knows a lot, so I guess I'll just take him at his word. He must know what he's talking about. He runs the seminary, right? He says, genuine regeneration is manifested by fruits worthy of repentance as demonstrated in righteous attitudes and conduct. Really, John? What type of righteous attitudes and conduct? How about the fact that you kept a known pedophile on your staff for years on your staff and you knew about it and you kept him on? I think he was in the choir or the worship team. Is that righteous attitude and good conduct? Are you saved? I mean, you let him on your staff.
John MacArthur is a false prophet.
denies the blood of Christ.
Yeah, we're not saved by his bleeding because it wouldn't have done any good if he just bled. If Jesus had just bled, nobody would be saved. The wages of sin is not bleeding. The wages of sin is death. It's not the bleeding of Jesus, and it's not the blood of Jesus. To speak of the blood of the cross, the blood of the cross, is to simply speak of the efficacious, substitutionary, sacrificial death of Christ.
I mean, I don't even know what that word meant. So I had to look it up. He could have just said it was his death that was enough. But some people, apparently, a lot of these false prophets, they like to use big, swelling words. Right? They want to say these words. Just, oh my, wow, John, you're just so smart. Look, just say it plainly.
Look at the way he sort of looks down and then he's like awkwardly looking up at his audience as he tries to defend himself. It's like he knows how blasphemous what he just said is. But then instead of just apologizing and say, look, I said a stupid thing, it was a mistake, he has to go to the ends of the earth to defend himself. And then like a child being told off by the principal, he's like looking down, just awkwardly looking. Well, I don't think this is, people came again. Like, just, he knows how bad this is.
Do I think he had to actually die, actually bleed? No, not to save us, but to fulfill the Old Testament picture. Somebody suggested that I might have thought he could be bludgeoned to death. Well, I suppose if God had decided that's the way he would die, it would be fine. But the pattern and the picture of the shedding of blood was in the whole Old Testament sacrificial system. And as the fulfillment and the final lamb, he fit that model and that pattern. But we are not saved by his blood.
The Bible says without the shedding of blood, there's no remission. Yep. He shed his blood on the cross.
Amen.
In 1987, a preacher who has denied the efficacy of the blood of Christ, Dr. John MacArthur, and in early August, I received a call from Dr. MacArthur's secretary, who told me that Dr. MacArthur would like to meet with me. I agreed to meet, and I said, we'll meet in my office. He walked in, and he said, what do you have against my doctrine on the blood of Christ? I said, Dr. MacArthur, I have several things against your doctrine. I said, for example, in your 1976 letter, you said in one sentence, there's nothing in his human blood that saves. And I said, Dr. MacArthur, in that one sentence, there are two heresies. I said, first of all, his blood was not human blood. His blood was the blood of God.
Amen.
MacArthur said, where do you get that? I said, I get that in Acts 20:28, where the Bible says, feed the church of God, which he hath purchased with his own blood. He said, so you make the antecedent of God, the word God. I said, it's the only possible antecedent. I have checked with college grammarians about that. And I said, secondly, the Bible says we are justified by his blood. We have peace with God through his blood. We are made near unto God by his blood. We have remission of sins through his blood. We have forgiveness through his blood. And I said, I believe all those things spell salvation. We continued our debate for a little over an hour, about an hour and 10 minutes, if I recall. And his voice got louder and louder as he became more and more frustrated. And finally, he got up and walked out of the office, and his assistant followed him. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission.
Amen.
Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness.
Mr. Anti-Prosperity himself appears to be living the lavish millionaire lifestyle of your run-of-the-mill prosperity preacher, and to a degree even more opulent than some of the worst. Indeed, if you do a little bit of cursory research, John MacArthur's net worth far exceeds some notable names. Some estimates are hovering right around the $14 million mark, which for many people is not a surprise. It's not a surprise.
Recently, go on YouTube and see it for yourself. Recently, John MacArthur, the man who denies the blood, one of the most popular preachers in America, okay, he recently stated that if you take the mark of the beast during the tribulation, you can still be saved. He just came, I mean, when is this guy gonna stop? Okay, when are people gonna stop listening to this guy? He's popular, they love him. I mean, if that's not satanic, well, we already knew he was satanic when he said the blood of Jesus doesn't wash away your sins. We already knew he was satanic when he's preaching work salvation. But look, he's popular.
You say, well, Billy, what really do I have to do?
First, you have to be willing to repent of your sin. And then the second thing, you must receive him by faith. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Just simple faith, like a little child believes in its father, its mother.
If the second step in this process is a simple faith, then we ought to expect the first step to be simple, correct?
First, you have to be willing to repent of your sin. You say, well, what does that mean? That means to change your way of living, to change your thinking about Christ and about God and about yourself. It means to live a new kind of a life. It means that you're willing to give up some of those wrong things in your life and walk with him. That's repentance. And Jesus said, except a man repent, he can't see the kingdom of God. Have you repented? Are you sure of it? Did that change take place? I'm not talking about, did you say, oh Lord, I'm sorry. That's not repentance. Oh Lord, I've sinned. That's not repentance. It means a change. All things have passed away and everything becomes new.
This really ought to show you why the repent of your sins gospel message, or this change lifestyle message, is so convoluted. Because in every sentence, it means a completely different thing. In one sentence, it's a changed lifestyle, and we need to be able to see that change and observe that change and live this new kind of a life. In another sentence, it's just, well, you have to be willing to change. Well, I don't remember that verse in the Bible, but willing to change. Well, how willing? How much change has there got to be? How many wrong things? How different is my lifestyle going to look? This is so ambiguous and vague. Nobody knows what this means. And he's saying, well, I can't just say I'm sorry. I can't just confess my sins. There's actually got to be a change. Well, you know, when John the Baptist preached repentance, which has nothing to do with turning from your sins, by the way, but that's a different story for another day. They confessed their sins. It doesn't say they poured their alcohol down and burnt all their nude pics in the presence of John the Baptist. It just doesn't say that. It says they confessed their sins. That's all they did. But that's not enough, apparently, according to Billy Graham. And, you know, all these different Christians give us all these different answers. We're getting multiple answers from one person, let alone all these other Christians that have their own answers.
Because if you ask a different Christian, they all have different answers. Well, you can have different answers. Maybe you're right, maybe you're wrong. But if you guys have different answers, then at least maximum one of you is the only one who could possibly be right, and the rest of you are all accursed. If you have different answers, and they all do.
And then after all of that, he says, you know, did that change take place? Can you look up back on your life before Billy Graham preaches this sermon, and did you see that change happen? And then people criticize me when I bring this stuff up, and oh, well, you know, he doesn't preach that you have to turn your life around before you can get saved, because he invites everybody at the end to the altar call, so they don't, he can't tell if they're going to change their life or not. Well, yes, that's part of the hypocrisy of it all. It's so hypocritical, and it makes no sense.
And I'm warning you about a very bad person who everyone thinks is wonderful. Why Billy Graham is on his way to hell. You say, I already don't like the sermon. It's only going to get worse from here. Why Billy Graham is on his way to hell? Number one, because he believes in salvation outside of Jesus Christ.
And that's what God is doing today. He's calling people for out of the world for his name, whether they come from the Muslim world or the Buddhist world or the Christian world or the non-believing world. They are members of the body of Christ because they've been called by God. They may not even know the name of Jesus, but they know in their heart that they need something that they don't have, and they turn to the only light that they have, and I think that they are saved and that they're going to be with us in heaven.
Now, is God a respecter of persons? No, he's not. The Bible says in John 14:6, Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the way, the truth, the life, and no man cometh unto the Father but by me. Acts 4:12, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Pretty clear, isn't the Bible, about the way to heaven?
This is fantastic. I'm so thrilled to hear you say that. There's a wideness in God's mercy.
There is.
Yeah, there's a widening in God's mercy until people die and find out when they get to hell that what he was saying was a lie, because he's a false prophet. He believes that there's salvation outside of Jesus Christ, and he doesn't believe that Jesus is he, and he's going to die in his sins.
And they turn to the only light that they have, and I think that they are saved, and they're going to be with us in heaven.
I don't care what you think, Billy Balaam. I don't care what you think, Dr. Billy Graham. I don't care what you think, wolf in sheep's clothing. I don't care what anybody thinks. I care what the Bible says. And the Bible says there's no salvation outside of Jesus Christ. And if you don't believe that, Billy Graham, you shall die in your sins.
You seem to be welcoming the Pope's visit to the United States. How do you combine being a Protestant, a Baptist, a fundamentalist, and welcoming the Pope?
Well, you know, when I went to Poland last year, he supported my going to Poland. When the episcopate met, the Catholic Church in Poland supported my coming. I preached in Krakow in St. Anne's Cathedral, Roman Catholic Cathedral, to 4,000 students and thousands in the streets. And he was to have presented me that evening. But he was at the conclave in Rome, and I have never met him. But I could sense by the people around him that he's a very devout man. Now, secondly, there's a big change taking place throughout the world. You have the great charismatic movement, and you have in southern Poland, for example, where he came from, hundreds of prayer groups and Bible study groups going on among Roman Catholics. And there is a renewal going on in Protestantism and Catholicism. And wherever you find people who are renewed in Christ and have been born again in Christ, no matter what their labels, you'll find that they have a greater affinity than some of the old past prejudices we used to have. There are differences, yeah. Still there. They've not been reconciled. But the Holy Spirit is moving mightily in certain areas of the Roman Catholic Church and certain areas of the Protestant Church, which sort of melts our hearts together.
This is a false teaching, is what this is. This is a false prophet. This is baloney. I can't believe people actually fall for this. Because his name's Billy Graham, that means he must be great and godly and teaching correct. Wrong.
And, of course, I do believe in abortion for those who've been raped, for those who may be diseased to the point that the child will be affected. I think there are certain areas that we need some of our laws brought up to date.
So there you have it. Billy said that you should be able to kill an unborn baby if it is the product of an assault on its mother.
Making allowances for abortion because the mother was raped isn't a moral framework that you got from the Bible. You got that from the evil, wicked world that puts the rapist in prison for about 5 or 10 years and then comes up with an excuse to abort the baby. The Bible does not teach to spare the rapist and kill the child. The Bible says spare the child and kill the rapist. Stone those rapists with stones. That's how you solve rape.
Since Billy Graham's demise, Satan has handed over the responsibility of being the world-renowned repent-of-your-sins evangelist to Ray Comfort and his ilk.
What's the biblical definition of repentance, Ray?
Confessing and forsaking your sins, I think.
You didn't even have to add the I think.
Oh, I mean, that's what Scripture says. Yeah. Who covers his sin shall not prosper, whoever confesses and forsakes them shall have mercy. So it's confessing and forsaking.
Okay, so I'm going to show you guys how this biblically illiterate fool interprets the Bible. So he's just plucked some random verse from Proverbs 28 and says, that's what repentance means. Now, can you show me the word repent in that verse? No, you can't. So what he's done is he's just plucked some random verse and joined it onto repentance and said, here, that's what repentance means. Well, I can do the same thing. What if I told you that if you truly have faith in Jesus, you will go on some sort of, you know, religious trip and go and see Jerusalem? I mean, look, it says right here in Matthew 20:18, behold, we go up to Jerusalem. Jesus took his disciples up to Jerusalem. The Bible says you have to have faith, so that's what you have to do. It's ridiculous. They're not connected. He's just joining random verses. And this is what false prophets do. They just cherry pick random verses and throw them together as if they belong together. Now, going back to Proverbs, does it say that he who covers his sins shall go to hell? No, it doesn't. Does it say that whosoever confesses and forsakes his sins shall go to heaven and get eternal life? It doesn't say that, folks. Once again, false prophets take a passage that is not an eternal life proof text, and they make that the answer to the question, sirs, what must I do to be saved?
There are those out there, Christians, who believe that repentance is merely changing your mind.
That's crazy.
Okay. Why is that crazy? Because that is part of repentance, right? You've got to change your mind, but why doesn't it stop there?
Well, if you become a Christian, you've been robbing banks. You don't change your mind about robbing banks and keep robbing banks. You stop robbing banks.
We allow the Bible to define itself. We don't say, here's what John was preaching. We let the Bible tell us what John was preaching. We let Jesus tell us what John was preaching. Notice what Jesus said, Matthew 21:32. For John came unto you in the way of righteousness, and ye, notice his word, believed. That's the message. That's the goal. and ye believed him not. He said, John came preaching. John came saying all those things, you know, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand, and ye believe him not. Now notice what Jesus says. But the publicans, those are the really bad sinners, and the harlots, those are the really bad sinners, believed him. He said, you religious people, you didn't believe him, but these really bad people, they believed him. Now notice, don't miss this. Notice what he says. And ye, when ye had seen it, repented not. He said, here's your problem. You didn't believe them. You should have repented. And the Pharisees would say, us repent? We're not the harlots. We're not the publicans. We're not the bad sinners. But notice what he says. And ye, when ye had seen it, repented not afterward. Notice what the repentance would have brought forth, that ye might believe him. Here's what he's saying. You weren't believing. They did believe. You should have repented and turned or changed your mind from not believing to believing.
In a recent video, Ray Comfort stated that his favorite disciple by far is Judas Iscariot. That's like me saying that my favorite angel by far is Lucifer. It's a bit of a weird thing to say. Ray goes on to use Judas as an example to substantiate the claim that it's not enough to believe in Jesus, despite literally scores of verses that I've already covered that teach salvation is by grace through faith alone. The Bible says in Acts chapter 16, for example, it puts forth the question, what must I do to be saved? And they said what? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved? No, according to Ray Comfort, this is insufficient. According to Ray Comfort, it's not enough to believe in Jesus.
By far my favorite disciple is Judas Iscariot. He being dead for 2,000 years still speaks, and he speaks volumes. He's a signpost of where not to go and the sternest of warnings of what not to do. He showed me that it's not enough to believe in Jesus.
The foolishness of using Judas Iscariot as an example in this context lies in the fact that the word of God is clear, Judas never believed on Jesus. Notice what Jesus himself says in John chapter 6, starting off in verse 64. But there are some of you that what? Believe not. For Jesus knew from the beginning, don't miss that, from the beginning, who they were that what? Believed not. And who should betray him? Who betrayed Jesus? The obvious answer is Judas Iscariot. From the beginning, Judas believed not according to the words of Christ.
An argument to that is, well, now you're calling people to do a work. You're telling them to work for salvation by turning from their sin.
And you wrote a wonderful thing on the blog thing. Wrote it? Yes.
I wasn't even trying to get a plug there, but okay.
But it was really good how you brought out the Philippian jailer said, what must I do to be saved? And Paul turned to him and said, what do you mean, do?
It's either by Jesus alone in him, because he's the only person that has power to forgive sins, not you, not yourself, Ray Discomfort, okay? It's by Jesus, by faith alone.
People that recognize that he has a false gospel and comment on my channel will say that, you know, he's good at showing people that they're guilty under the law. The problem is that he makes people believe that you get a not guilty status by your performance to the law, and that's the gospel that he presents, ultimately, that you have to keep the law to some measure or some degree in order to be justified and have eternal life.
Some preacher tries to convince you that legalism is just work salvation and that's it, okay? And why is that a trap? Because, you know, the whole reason they do that is that they want to basically come out and say, oh, see, I'm not preaching work salvation, so I'm not a legalist. You know, and then they just start preaching the law at you.
God's word shows us three uses or three purposes of God's law or commandments. And it is important that we understand each one of these three and also keep them separate. We cannot collapse any of these three together. And so the first use is going to be the political or societal, the civil use of the law. And so the law is given by God to nations and to peoples in order to deter violence and crime and the unruliness of godless men. The second use of the law is known as the eleictical use, and this is simply to show us our guilt before God and our need for Christ as Savior, right? And so this is how evangelism is going to typically begin. You will show the sinner, the person you're evangelizing, how they have failed to keep God's law perfectly, and are therefore, according to the word of God, condemned to hell. You know, outside of any intercession from Christ, that is their condemnation. They're going to hell. There's no way around it as a result of breaking God's law. The third use of law is also known as the didactic use of the law, and it is as a guide or a moral standard by which the regenerate, the saved, God's children to live by. Now, this is not to be collapsed with justification, okay? Justification does not hinge upon your adherence to the law. Okay, the third use of law has nothing to do with justification. Justification is a legal or forensic declaration where God declares you not only innocent, but righteous based on the work of Jesus Christ. When you have trusted in it, when you've had faith in Christ, God declares you righteous. He declares you not guilty. And this verdict cannot be improved upon, right? No adherence to the third use of the law is going to improve upon this verdict, right? The verdict is final. You don't get better than not guilty and righteous.
When you take a look at American Christianity, it is based more upon a godless culture than it is upon the Word of God. And so many people are deceived, and so many youth are deceived, and so many adults are deceived into believing that because they prayed a prayer one time in their life, they're going to heaven. Nothing troubles their heart. They think, well, I'm the same as most in my youth group. I watch things I shouldn't watch on television and laugh about the very things that God hates. I wear clothing that is sensual. I talk like the world. I walk like the world. I love the music of the world. I love so much that's in the world. But bless God, I am a Christian. Why am I a Christian? Because there was a time in my life when I prayed and asked Jesus Christ to come into my heart. I want you to know that the greatest heresy in the American evangelical and Protestant church is that if you pray and ask Jesus Christ to come into your heart, He will definitely come in. What you need to know is that salvation is by faith and faith alone in Jesus Christ. And faith alone in Jesus Christ is preceded and followed by repentance. A turning away from sin, a hatred for the things that God hates and a love for the things that God loves, a growing in holiness and a desire not to be like Britney Spears, not to be like the world, and not to be like the great majority of American Christians, but to be like Jesus Christ. I don't know why you're clapping. I'm talking about you.
So basically, I'm looking around, I'm inspecting, and I don't see enough fruit here, so you're all not saved and you're going to go to hell when you die. I mean, he almost literally says this. He says that he believes the majority of his audience is not saved and they'll be in hell in 100 years. And he's propping up this idea that you can look at someone, inspect their fruit, and based off the changes they've made in their life, the works that they do, determine whether or not they are saved. And he's using Matthew 7 to support this idea, which is why he uses it as the premise for his whole sermon. But it's a false premise, because that is not the context of Matthew 7 at all. Matthew 7 is not saying that you can look at an average churchgoer's fruit, you know, their life, their changes they made in their life, their works, and decide based off that whether they're saved or not. Let's look at the context. Matthew chapter 7 verse 15 says, "Beware of false prophets, which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. Ye shall know them," the false prophets, "by their fruits." So number one, this passage is about false prophets. You can know false prophets by their fruits, right? That's the first error he makes. The second is assuming that fruits necessarily means works or changes in your life. And that's not what it means. If you're going to use the Bible to interpret the Bible, you could just go fast forward a couple chapters in this very same book of Matthew to get your definition of fruits, of what the Bible means by fruits. In Matthew chapter 12, just five chapters later, Jesus makes this clear. Either make the tree good and his fruit good, or else make the tree corrupt or his fruit corrupt, for the tree is known by his fruit. So same subject is being addressed here. Let's go on. O generation of vipers, how can ye, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. A good man out of the good treasure of the heart bringeth forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things. But I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give an account thereof in the day of judgment. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. So Jesus defines fruit here as your words, right? And this makes sense when you're talking about the false prophets of Matthew 7 and how you can judge them by their fruits, because you can judge a preacher by his words, by the doctrine he's teaching. That's not to say that there isn't evidence of salvation. I believe there is evidence of salvation. But what is not biblical is that this idea that you can just inspect someone's fruit in their life and determine based off that necessarily whether or not they are saved, that is not biblical. And that is basically the what Paul Washer's ministry is all about.
The Bible doesn't say obey this, and you're going to go to heaven. No, the Bible says love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind. He says, I want to have a relationship with you. I want you to hear the message tonight and go, are you kidding me? So you're sitting on this throne up there. You're in unapproachable light. There's 100 million angels, and you mean to tell me that rather than punishing me, you, Almighty God, sent your Son to die on a cross for me, and that if I truly believe in that and I'm ready to just walk away from my life and follow that and devote myself to Jesus, to just die to myself and follow him, that you'll put your spirit in me and that's it? So I don't have to actually do something to earn my salvation. I just have to believe to that extreme and boom, I'm there. Man, where do I sign up?
Francis Chan really epitomizes the stereotype of a Lordship Protestant or Evangelical Christian. Now, he suffers from Lordship Spectrum Disorder, so just like many others, he'll say, well, it's by faith alone, you know, it's by believing, it's not by obeying, in one discourse. But then in another discourse, oh, you have to obey, you have to deny yourself. Well, then I don't know what it's by then. I don't know what this guy believes. And another thing he has to do is, like, emotionally manipulate people into thinking that he's a godly man with just so much love for Jesus. You see, if you preach the truth stands up for itself. Okay, Francis's swelling words, they don't, so he has to put on this emotional show of just like, oh man, I love this beautiful God and his glorious throne, and I just weep and I tremble with this whiny, emotionally manipulative voice, and he moves his arms around like that, because he's trying to manipulate people into thinking that he loves God, and he just has this uncontainable love for God that most of us just don't have, and we want it, but we just don't have it. But Francis Chan has it, because look at the way that he's expressing it. Well, to those of us who actually know the Bible and the clear plan of salvation, your fuzzy gospel message with all of your emotionalism and sensationalism, it doesn't show us that you love God, okay? You either look like you need the toilet or you're having a heart attack, okay? You look ridiculous, and it doesn't deceive us. It only deceives unsaved Christians who love it when you put on a show. Over the last few years, many evangelicals have been very concerned over Francis Chan kind of going off the deep end and becoming heretical, because he's been yoking up with a bunch of obvious heretics, like in the NAR movement, or he's foaming at the mouth with a very unhealthy fascination with communion, and he wants to replace teaching as the central responsibility of the church with communion. And so, you know, he might be going back to Catholicism and Orthodoxy and bringing in this ecumenicalism, because, you know, they're so fascinated with communion as the big central thing over and above everything else. Now, communion is important and it reminds us of what Christ did, but it's not so hugely emphasised in the New Testament, and the only concrete teaching we have about communion, outside of the Last Supper anyway, is a bad example in the Corinthian church. But the rest of the New Testament, it's teaching us about this, or it's teaching us about that, it's, you know, teaching this doctrine and that doctrine. So it's the teaching that's the most important role of the church, to edify the saints and to teach the right gospel to the unbeliever. So I'm not really worried about Francis Chan going apostate or, you know, going into heresy, because guess what? He's always been a heretic, okay? He's always had a two-faced gospel message. That's why Chan can walk into any church, really, whether it's Protestant or Reformed or Charismatic or Catholic or whatever, and he'll get huge groups of people to come and listen to him, and, you know, they'll just pack out that building, and he'll receive the praise of men in the video comments on YouTube, because his gospel is so fluffy that they all agree with it. And so, you know, you need to surrender your life, and you need to deny yourself, and you need to turn from your sins. But not me, Francis Chan. I'm very special. I'm above these things. It's just you that needs to do these things.
One of his sermons, he was basically just whining, like Paul Washer, basically saying how afraid he was for his congregants, because he was afraid they're going to go to hell.
I am deeply concerned that even though you are sitting in a church building, that some of you one day will go to hell to be tormented day and night forever and ever. And by the time you figure it out, it'll be too late. That's my biggest concern.
Why isn't he concerned about himself going to hell? The reason why he's so scared is because he doesn't know the gospel. He doesn't understand how to be saved.
You say the only proof that you have the Holy Spirit is if you're acting a certain way.
it's funny because these people will always think that they're acting good enough to prove that they're saved. But then if someone else isn't living the way they are, then that person probably isn't saved. Like, their standard for righteousness is like their own lifestyle. It's not God's perfect standard. You know, if we had to prove we were saved by our works and that God would automatically produce these works in us, then they would be perfect. They wouldn't be imperfect because it's God doing the work, right? You're just like the Pharisees. Exactly like them. A bunch of religious, self-righteous, hypocritical Pharisees. You are a hypocrite. That's what the leaven of the Pharisees is. It's hypocrisy.
This is often coming from a lot of people who say, you need to repent of your sins to be saved. Well, firstly, I've yet to see anywhere in the King James Bible, which I know pretty well, where it says I need to do any of that to be saved because I'm believing by childlike faith. Now, I detest Lordship salvation with a passion, just like how obviously God detests it and every other saved person out there when they realize what it is. In the beginning, when there was Adam and Eve, Lordship salvation did abound. And the reason why was because they didn't need a savior then. That was the original plan of Earth to be like that. Yeah? And then sin ended the world. So guess what? Because sin's ended the world, we now need a savior. Because we can't save ourselves. Now I'm just honing in on a lot of people who go to Episcopalian church and or Church of England, depending on which side of the water you're on. I don't think every single person is unsaved who goes there. However, because they're being generally taught by unsaved people, they're not going to gain no meat. Yeah, they might learn a couple of things in terms of historical things or whatever. I'm not saying that. But in terms of deep scripture, they're not going to get that. And if they do, it's going to be wrong, or it's just going to be nonsense.
Time would not permit me to go through the hypocrisy of all the preachers of Lordship salvation, otherwise this documentary would go on forever. Even among the most famous ones, we have barely covered a handful. But they are the exemplifications of Protestant and Evangelical Christianity and any proto-Christian cults that broke away from it. Like their Catholic predecessors, they tell you to turn from your own sins and to have a changed lifestyle, when they themselves do not live this righteous lifestyle and have refused correction when confronted. Torben Zondergaard of the Last Reformation was known for doing fake miracles, such as the leg lengthening trick. He faked stories about persecution in Denmark to obtain asylum in the United States, then lied about the reason why he was arrested in the US, and has frequently asked money for projects that never came to fruition. But he still wants to tell you.
We cannot go on sinning. We cannot have a sinful lifestyle. If we sin, we ask forgiveness and he's faithful and righteous to forgive us. But if our life is a sinful lifestyle, then we have a nature of sin and go on sinning and can sin without being totally destroyed and condemned and repent and run away from it, then we're not born again.
Young Don Reborn, who has recently had a lot of exposure and rebuke after having turned away from the doctrines of grace, is now hardlining that faith must produce works. So he shows his obedience by inviting a rabbi on his channel and calling him rabbi when Jesus said, "Call no man rabbi." He also sounds the trumpet every time somebody donates money to his channel, praising donors for the love of money.
The Kingdom of Heaven online with a tenner. And then Kai Jack with a fiver. Jesus, what's up, brother? Jesus with a tenner.
Double-minded Isaiah Saldivar says salvation is free, but also says it cost everything, talking out of both sides of his mouth.
You need to contend for your salvation. Salvation is free. Do not get it twisted. We can never do anything to earn it. None of us did anything to get it, but understand it cost everything.
Salvation is free, but understand it cost everything.
That doesn't make sense.
Michael Brown insists that true repentance is a turning away from sin, so he yokes up with charismatic heretics and promotes unbiblical nonsense to demonstrate his turning from sin. Bible Flockbox has one of the largest followings of any Christian YouTube channel, telling you that if you have truly repented, you won't go on living a sinful lifestyle. Yet he is a false Seventh-day Adventist, who, as well as promoting their unique heresies, also promotes many of the same false heresies as the Jehovah's false witnesses, such as denying the doctrine of hell, which is the soul sleep doctrine, and denying the eternal nature of the lake of fire, hence making sin and death of no real effect by removing any real consequences for sins. The list of these hypocrites is endless. But there is one small, righteous remnant of true believers who cry aloud and spare not against all of these hypocrites.
The Bible says, unless you repent, you will perish. Unless you turn from your sin, you're gonna burn in hell.
They boldly proclaim that it is not good enough to tell people to be penitent of their sins while still so unrepentantly bowing down to statues of Mary.
That's all, it's not an idol. You can bow down all you want to, and Mary is not going to hear you. I don't hear a cry.
They boldly proclaim that it is not acceptable to be a carnal, lukewarm Christian who will only repent of some sins, but not all, if they expect to make it into heaven.
And that's why I say we must turn from all known sin. A person cannot be a Christian. A person cannot be saved. A person cannot receive eternal life if he harbors in his life any known sin.
They boldly proclaim that it is not acceptable to tickle men's ears by saying that they might struggle with some sins, but may still keep their salvation.
Why people are condemned to hell is because they love their sin and they don't really want to repent of it. And they go around making excuses saying, I can't repent. God will forgive us because we're just human. If you start making all those excuses why you can't give up pornography, the lusts of the flesh, pride, then you're not truly repenting and the Lord will not forgive you.
Presenting themselves as the sanctified righteous remnant that truly love God, they set the utmost standards for Christians to live a holy life as something you must do to be saved.
But when you're repented of your sins, you've been forgiven by Jesus Christ, you don't look forward to sinning. You look forward to going out and evangelizing on Friday night. You look forward to going to church and going to prayer meetings. You look forward to reading your Bible. You look forward to abstaining from the devil, from rejecting the devil.
Preaching holiness from the rooftops, they so boldly proclaim that you absolutely must turn from all sins and walk in holiness, as Jesus said. Go and sin no more.
It's not about us accepting Jesus. It's not about us accepting Jesus. It's about Jesus accepting you. And he's only going to accept those who repent and forsake all known sin, turn away from all their iniquity and all their transgressions, and turn to Jesus Christ.
After all, it worked for them, didn't it?
I stopped sinning. Have you stopped sinning? You better stop sinning.
Because I'm sitting here and I'm telling you that it's possible to be living a life where you no longer sin, where you no longer get sick, and you're allowing the Holy Spirit of Jesus Christ to guide you.
So I went to this cabin who was basically surrounded by woods. I said, 30 days and I'm going to get rid of Netflix. I'm going to get rid of YouTube. I'm going to get rid of all these things. I'm going to separate myself and I'm going to seek God with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. And I said, I'm going to do what we hear here, where it says forsaking all. If you don't forsake all, you can't be my disciple. So going there to forsake everything else and say, God, and I just sought God with all of my heart during this time.
The I stands for you must have a testimony filled with eyes, like I turned from my sins. I did the good works.
There's a verse in the Bible that says all things should be done decently and in order. When I was a young man, that Bible verse influenced my life. My house is in order. My business is in order. My work van is in order. Everything is in order. It's not just when I go out and preach. Some guys, they live like a mess.
The M stands for me. It's all about me.
Well, now I knew that I was truly saved, so nobody could have convinced me that I wasn't. I knew that I had truly believed on Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. I had a very, very powerful conversion experience. It was very miraculous. It was very profound. And at that time, he began to also bear fruit in my life. I mean, so it was one thing after the next of him sanctifying me, of him cleansing me from all kinds of different things.
You have this powerful testimony. You know, last time I checked, the gospel of Jesus Christ was the power of God unto salvation, not your testimony. Last time I checked, the gospel of Christ is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. The Bible says the preaching of the cross is to us that are saved. It's the power of God. Amen. The cross, the death, the burial, and resurrection, it's about Jesus. It's not about you.
When I repented, every single sin that I knew of that was in my life, I turned away from. Things that I knew were wrong, impure relationships, sexual perversions, things like pornography, things like listening to music that's ungodly, anything and everything that I knew was sin, I turned away from. And when I repented, I just gave all of that up to follow Jesus, and to this day, I haven't turned back to those things. All those idols, I got rid of as quickly as I could. I watched movies quite a bit, and I got rid of all my movies. I threw out my TV. I don't watch any television or movies or anything like that.
The first reason why I'm a shoo-in for heaven is because I've stopped watching the Smurfs. Nobody can watch the Smurfs and expect to go to heaven. And you too can go to heaven, but only if you become a special, anointed, and repentant, and amazing as me.
And I remember just talking to God and saying, God, I'm giving my life to you. Today I'll never be the same. And I wasn't. I was 16 years old, I gave my life to Christ, and the change in my life was instant and absolutely radical.
I stopped doing drugs, I stopped selling drugs, you know, and I had been selling drugs since I was about 14 years old. Gave up all my sin, gave up all my friends, all the partying, and I was quite popular in school, and started just to become a loner. Just read my Bible, you know, went home after school every day and just to read the Bible. No longer going out to the parties and hanging out with friends, but just seeking God and seeking His Word, seeking His presence.
Go, man, I was snorting so much cocaine, and I was in jail, and I was in prison, and I held the gun to my mouth every single day to blow my own brains out. I was so miserable, and then God reached down and saved a poor, wretched, vile, lost soul like me.
The devil's going to try to take away your testimony. Don't stop giving your testimony. It's powerful. It's strong. But you got to proclaim it from the rooftops, what God has done for you.
Folks, that's not what it's about, my friend. You know what it's about? It's about God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. You know, when I go out soul winning door to door, I don't tell people my life story. I tell people Jesus' life story.
These people are referred to by other Christians as sinless perfectionists. They won't always use that label to describe themselves, and may resent being given that label by other Christians. Their doctrine is that you must turn from all sin, and you must produce works to accompany your faith in utmost holiness, surrendering everything to the Lord, fighting the fight of faith, and paying a very heavy cost for the gift of salvation.
You got to turn from what you love. You got to turn from your sins. You got to count the cost. Okay? And if you love your sin, you're not hungering and thirsting after righteousness.
Forgiveness of sins only applies to past sins. It does not apply to present or future sins. One must repent of past sins and stop continuing in sin.
Easy believists constantly repeat this line that God forgives all sin, past, present, and future.
Once you trust in Jesus Christ as your Savior, He forgives you of all your sins, past, present, and future.
Jesus quite clearly explains in the gospel that sins have been paid for past, present, and future.
Well, the sinless perfectionists refute this by saying that the Bible doesn't really say that anywhere. In fact, God's forgiveness is only for past sin, not present and future sin.
Deceiving preachers present such a God to you, one who knows that you will definitely sin again, but is so loving that he forgives you for all time. The problem is, this God of total and unconditional forgiveness does not exist. Servants of Satan preach that Christians will continue to sin, and God's love is so great to cover all sin for all time. But the Bible never says the blood of Jesus applies to past, present, and future sin. In fact, Scripture explicitly says God only applies the blood of Jesus for forgiveness of sins that are past.
Romans 3:25 says that God had passed over the sins that were previously committed. And 2 Peter 1:9 says that we were cleansed from our old sins, not present and future sins. No.
That means the blood only covered what? Like, whichever sins you're good at stopping? You're your own savior.
Why is there so much argument about this? You would think that a doctrine as basic as and important as this would be well documented in the Bible, wouldn't you? You know, you would expect the Bible to just be so blatantly obvious about this, and yet for some reason it's not. Now, the problem with this debate is that the supporting verses that easy believists use to say that God forgives all sin, past, present, and future, is that the key supporting verses are actually really cryptic. The underlying Greek is difficult to translate into English. The English words, we don't really use them a lot either. So easy believers, they just quote these verses without explaining them, and then they just expect average Joe to figure out what they mean. So let's look at a few examples of these difficult cryptic verses. So it says in Colossians 2:13, "And you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he has quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses." So you can see that word is really confusing there, so scholars are not quite sure how best to translate it. There isn't really a suitable word in English. And, you know, we don't really use this word in our everyday vernacular. So, you know, average Joe just has no idea what that word there means. But there's a couple of other examples as well in the Bible that use this same cryptic word. So the two other uses of this word particularly come from 1 John 1, both of them. So there's verse 7 and verse 9. So in verse 7 it says, "But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, the Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin." So again, there's that confusing word there. And it goes on to say in verse 9, "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." So, you know, on behalf of God, let me just apologize that, you know, this is so confusing.
Easy believists and sinless perfectionists both have access to the Bible. How is it possible that two groups of people use the same source of text and yet have completely and utterly opposing doctrines?
The Bible is the most important tool that we have as a weapon of spiritual warfare, and this book is the final authority concerning who God is, what God did and said, and over again in this book, various prophets and Jesus himself emphasised the importance of words, particularly written words. There are loads of verses in the Bible that say, "It is written, it is written, it is written." So what is written in our Bibles is extremely important, and this is the biggest threat to Satan's workers and their false doctrines. So Satan's goal is to attack or undermine what is written. And there are several ways that his servants will do this. Now, some tactics are a bit more subtle than others. So, for example, they'll subtly change the odd word in the Bible to mean something slightly different and change the meaning of the sentence.
"I have written unto you, young man, because you are strong and the word of God abideth in you, and you have overcome the wicked one."
In this clip, Reuben Israel quotes 1 John 2:13, and when quoting the verse directly, he does correctly quote it as saying, "You have overcome the wicked one." The wicked one is a generic third-person pronoun, which is the closest acceptable translation in English for the underlying Greek, which uses a masculine accusative case, not featured in English pronouns. The implication here is that the wicked one refers to a person, not an abstract concept, inanimate object, or action. Therefore, the definition of "you have overcome the wicked one" should refer to the devil or spirit of Antichrist in the context of the epistle.
"And you have overcome the wicked one." Young men, you know, who claim you got a problem with lust, who claim you got a problem with alcohol, who claim you got a problem with masturbation and porno. You know, he's saying very clearly here that these younger men should have overcome the wicked one, not living it, not walking it, not just partaking it from time to time. Overcome the wicked one.
Reuben Israel instead applied the verse to a man's personal sins, not the person that is the object of that verse. Even though he quoted the verse itself correctly, he changed the object of accusation, saying, not living it, not walking it, not partaking in it. Even though the verse says, you have overcome the wicked one, i.e. Satan or the spirit of Antichrist, his listeners would walk away thinking it actually says, you have overcome it, i.e. your personal sinful lifestyle. In doing so, he has subtly changed the meaning of the sentence by altering the thing or the one that is being overcome, without directly rewriting it. There are other examples of him doing this in the very same original source video.
Then he goes on to say, he that committeth sin is of the devil. Okay, that's just good old-fashioned English language. I believe in King James. I believe it's translated properly. I don't need to go into the Greek or Hebrew. I think the writers and scholars who put our Bible together did a fantastic job. And that is good old-fashioned English. It makes it very clear. He that committeth sin is of the devil.
Many modern versions of the Bible, such as the ESV, translate 1 John 3:8 as practicing sin instead of commit sin, as the King James Bible reads. Having endorsed the King James translation, can we assume that then Reuben Israel understood good old-fashioned English?
If you feel obligated to look up the Greek word just to try to justify you living in sin, something is wrong with you. He didn't say he that lives in sin, there's hope. No. John's pretty cut and dry. You live in sin, you are of the devil.
Having boasted about understanding good old-fashioned English and rebuking any go-back-to-the-Greek frauds, he has himself changed the English to justify his own sin. John very clearly said, he who commits sin is of the devil. Reuben Israel reinterpreted John's writings to say, he who lives in sin is of the devil. As modern translations of this verse already do, Israel's reinterpretation of this verse creates an artificial, vague, blurry line between living in sin, which is making a lifestyle practice of sin, and not living in sin, but maybe sinning as a one-off, even accidentally. When the Bible said, thou shalt not commit adultery, do you think it meant a lifestyle practice of living in adultery, or do you think it meant a one-time act of adultery? How many times does one have to do adultery to be guilty of committing it? The answer is simple, only one. The implication here is that if anybody, including Reuben Israel, sinned even just once, whether before or after his declared time of conversion, he is of the devil. This is exactly what happened. Now, Reuben Israel died during the production of this documentary, and just a couple of days before I found out that he died, I did a video commenting on a video that he released at the time, and it was titled Los Angeles Angels Deny Ticket Holding Christians Access to Game. Now, you'll notice that I've blurred out the thumbnail here, and the reason why I do that is because this thumbnail is a picture of cross-dressing drag queens. Okay, now these shouldn't be confused with people who have gender dysphoria and, you know, want to look like the other gender. They're just men who dress as overly sexualized, ridiculous caricatures which mock what real women look like. Okay, now the Bible says, set no wicked thing before mine eye. Okay, I should not have to look at this filth. It's bad enough we have to look at this every June when Pride comes around, and then a so-called man of God that tells us all to turn from our sins is pelting me in the eyes with this filth. And it's not like he actually spoke to drag queens in the video and it's just a thumbnail that shows a snapshot of the video. He never spoke to any drag queens in the video. So he's gone on the internet, searched for a picture of drag queens and stuck that in the thumbnail. Well, what if kids are gonna see that? You're molesting them in the eyes. I don't want to see that. And here's another point. Proverbs 23:20 speaks against those who are gluttonous with meat. So why was Mr. Turn from all of your sins to be saved
big and fat, like, I've repented of all of my sins, I'm crucified to flesh. So he went around telling everybody else to turn from their sins. He didn't participate in it himself. And as you can imagine, even other turn from your sins ilk decided to come on the video comments and make excuses and defend him. I mean, here's one. The Bible is right, he says, right? What do you mean we can't stop sinning? Are you sinning while making the video? You can stop sinning for sure. Right, okay, let's have a look at your channel then. Let's see most recent video. 4 months ago, oh, long hair. You know, the Bible says it's a shame to have long hair. You can't stop sinning. Well, you're not participating in it yourself, are you?
And in my own experience, I've met some of the sorriest, laziest, dumbest, filthiest, fattest, pothead bum slobs out there teaching works.
And then look what else he says. You can stop sinning, for sure. Jesus is proof of that. Oh, really? What sin did Jesus repent of, then?
Are these unsaved fools now telling me that our Lord needs to turn from sin? Is that what they're seriously telling me?
So this blasphemous fool is accusing Jesus of being a repentant sinner. No, the Bible says he was without sin, so stick that out your pipe and smoke it. Here's another one, road less travelled, making a defence for Reuben Israel, right? And he's saying, I wouldn't expect less from some greasy gracers who turn the grace of God into lasciviousness. Well, let's see this guy turn the grace of God into lasciviousness. So he makes an excuse for him being overweight. And then, but he refuses to address the fact that Reuben Israel put drag queens in the thumbnail. He had nothing to say about that. And I asked him to defend that multiple times. He did not answer it. He just refused to answer it in any of his comments. So they love to point at you and say, well, you're just making excuses for your sin. So what do? Make excuses for their sin. Feel comfortable in their sin. One rule for you and a different rule for these people. So the last video that Reuben Israel published before he died was something filthy that I shouldn't have to look at. Put no wicked thing before mine eyes. That's exactly what he did. So he sinned and lost his salvation. He was of the devil, by his own claim as to what that verse even means.
Hey, that's just good old-fashioned English language. I believe in King James. I believe it's translated properly. John's pretty cut and dry. You live in sin, you are of the devil.
The truth of the matter is that these people do not practice what they preach. They don't live up to their own standard. These people are nothing but stupid, unsaved, hell-bound hypocrites.
Some of them, although not all, say that they hear the voice of God. So don't trust too much in what is written. I hear God's voice, so I'll tell you what it really means, because God directs my understanding personally.
There were many times the Lord would give me a dream, and he would show me something. He's the one who gives me the messages that I put up. Those messages don't come from me. I don't contrive them. The Holy Spirit, he's the one who has started his work in me.
He started, you know, speaking to me through the word. At first it was just, you know, maybe once a week or so, a couple times a week, and then it progressed more and more to where he was speaking to me, you know, every single day.
I have a really important dream to share with you guys. I believe it's definitely a dream from the Lord, and it's a warning to all of us about these last days and what's going on right now in the church. It's a dream about false prophets. It's a dream about many people who think that they're saved, when in reality, they're not. And I want to share that with you. It's so important. So please watch this video all the way through and hear the dream that the Lord gave me.
And because they have supposedly turned from all of their sins, they are of the truth. So of course they hear God's voice. They wouldn't lie to you, would they?
I know God, so, you know, God will tell me the things I need to know about a person. So, right there, if I know that you're not being guided by the Spirit, then guess what? I know that you're deceived by the devil. I'm not guessing at these things. I know these things. I was taught these things by Jesus Christ himself. I can go to him about every little thing, and he's going to explain it to me. The majority of believers out there do not have that blessing in their life because they're not being guided by the Holy Spirit of Jesus Christ. If you're coming against me, if you're trying to sit there and say that what I'm relating is wrong, I'm going to tell you right now, you're a liar, you're deceived, you're ignorant, and you're a fool because you're condemning yourself to an eternity in hell.
And it sounds super spiritual, you know, they go to these verses about God revealing things to us, God teaching things to us. But the problem is that if we're going by the claim, God told me thus, well, I can't really test whether what you're hearing is true, and you're all claiming to hear the voice of God, but you all have different answers and different beliefs about things, and you even condemn each other. So when God tells you messages that contradict this, and you all contradict each other as well, I have no reason to trust you when you tell me that God told me thus and such. Even the ones that don't directly claim to hear the voice of God, outside of the Bible, must still be preaching the truth, surely. After all, they have turned from all of their sins, have they not? So they would never dream of preaching lies.
Because the darkness has blinded his eyes, no matter how much you know about Jesus, no matter how much you agree about what you know about Jesus, if you hate the one who is walking in the light with no darkness at all, you are blind and you do not know where you're going. And you are a liar claiming to have fellowship with God. And I'm speaking to every one of you of the apostate churches who come here and condemn and show your hatred towards me, because we must stop sin by the power of the Holy Spirit in cooperation with God. Oh, well, you know, it says that, but... And they'll explain it away.
Well, if these guys all believe in work salvation, if they all believe you have to turn from all of your sins to be saved, or at least all known sins, as some of them will say, and they all believe you can lose your salvation, well, maybe then they're hearing the voice of God, because all of these independent witnesses all agree on this same thing. I mean, God's not going to give them different messages, is he?
You got to realize that every false prophet out there, they know some type of truth. You know, there is some truth in him. But there's only one truth and one truth alone. So you either are sanctified in that truth and you totally understand it, or you're someone that's not, and you're simply guessing at it. You really don't understand what it's all about.
If you really want to know the truth, you will ask God, okay? And he will reveal to you the truth. There can't be two truths on this. The Holy Spirit can't be leading me in one direction and leading you in another. One of us has got to be wrong. And I know you're saying that it's me, but guys, you ask God.
Adam, abiding the word, is a Trinitarian, and he proclaims that repenting of sins is a work because he quoted a verse about doing works to justify this.
The word repent is absolutely used in the context of turning from sin. In Acts 26:20, it says they should repent and turn to God, performing deeds in keeping with their repentance.
Jesse Morell, also a Trinitarian, proclaims that repenting of sins is not a work, because he explicitly said so.
Repentance is not a work. Repentance, essentially, the word means a change of mind. To repent of sin, specifically.
In order for one of these men to be telling the truth, the other one is a liar for preaching a false repentance of sin message. Gabe the Street Preacher is a oneness modalist, denouncing the Trinity as paganism. Mike Rakowski is also a oneness modalist, denouncing the Trinity as Catholic paganism. Keith of Y City Preachers is a Trinitarian. Hal Chafee is also a Trinitarian. If the Trinitarians represent the true God, then the oneness modalists are blasphemous, denying the distinction between the Son and the Father. If the oneness modalists represent the true God, then the Trinitarians are pagans and idolaters. They all tell you that they've turned from all of their sins, but at least some of them preach a false Jesus. Andrew Tyner of Warning the People has stated that you do not need the Bible because the true God is outside of the Bible. He also says that it is idolatry to call the Bible the Word of God.
You do not need a church, you don't need religion, and you don't need a Bible. You don't have to go to church, you don't have to be a part of anyone's religion, and you also don't have to read the Bible. God is outside of church, he is outside of religion, and he is outside of the Bible.
Abide in the Word has published a public rebuke of Andrew Tyner, denouncing him as outrageous and blasphemous. Both of these men tell you that you have to walk in holiness, having turned from all your sins, and boast in themselves having turned from all of their sins. But if one of them is telling the truth, then the other is either blasphemous or idolatrous and a liar. Mike Rakowski believes that a true Christian who has turned from all his sins can never get sick. He claims that he himself can never catch any diseases or sickness. He doesn't have a preferred Bible translation. He says to use whichever Bible you are comfortable with. Ron Craig of The Rooted Word has publicly rebuked Mike Rakowski for his false teaching on sinless Christians never getting sick. He also believes that virtually all English Bible translations are wrong in some way, so he is in the process of writing his own Bible translation. Mike Rakowski is also very anti-church, denouncing the idea of conventional church setups, while Ron Craig is very firm about the authoritative role of the church. Both of these men claim to have turned from all of their sins, but they mutually claim that the other is a liar and ergo has not repented of all sins. Mike Rakowski also claims that God would never use women to teach or preach his truth. Women can share their testimony, but they cannot in any way teach doctrine and publish videos in the manner that he does. If this were true, then Michaela Cooper and Truth by Jesus, whose personal name I don't know, are both false prophetesses simply by default, even if they supposedly preach correctly about turning from all sins. If these women are doing God's work by preaching on their channels, then Mike Rakowski is a false teacher for preventing them from serving God. They all claim to have turned from all of their sins, but at least one of them, if not two, must be a liar. Apparently when Jesus said narrow is the way is so incredibly narrow that on a planet of over 8 billion people, Mike Rakowski is the only sanctified in truth disciple of Christ who has overcome all sickness and sin and has learned to test the spirits in this generation. Because he is the only sanctified in truth disciple among 8 billion people, it is impossible for him to sin, therefore it is impossible for him to get sick, and it is impossible for him to lose his salvation. But anybody else could sin and lose their salvation, and in doing so blaspheme the Spirit and never have a chance to be saved again. If even one of these so-called prophets are a true prophet of God, who has turned from all of their sins, then the vast majority, if not all of the others, are all false prophets.
Because if you ask a different Christian, they all have different answers. Well, you can have different answers. Maybe you're right, maybe you're wrong. But if you guys have different answers, then at least maximum one of you is the only one who could possibly be right, and the rest of you are all accursed. If you have different answers, and they all do.
They can claim to hear the voice of God all they want to, but going about on YouTube making claims like that doesn't prove anything. But these false prophets do know the Bible very well. But they know that most Christians don't know the Bible anywhere near as well as they do. So they're counting on your stupidity to not catch them out. So they use your lack of biblical knowledge to manipulate you. So one of their tactics, because they think you're too dumb to notice, is that they will subtly teach the exact opposite of what a biblical passage actually teaches. They know the Bible says this, they're going to tell you it actually says that.
There is no assurance of eternal life according to what you knew or claimed that Jesus did. Eternal life and eternal judgment is according to what you did. In Revelations 20:12, Apostle John says, "And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books, according to their works." Final judgment is according to how intensely you chose to obey or disobey God with what you were given.
We see every single instance of judgment in the Bible being based on our deeds. Let me show you what I'm talking about. Okay, "And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and the books were opened. Then another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged by what was written in the books, according to what they had done." According to this, you were judged based on whether or not your name was written in the book of life. And whether or not your name was written in the book of life was dependent upon what you had done.
It's almost embarrassing that I even have to counteract this. "And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened." So there's the books plural, and there's the book singular. Now the book singular is the book of life. The dead were judged out of those things written in the books, plural, according to their works. So who's judged according to their works in this passage? The dead, those not found in the book of life. What did those two reprobates just tell you? Oh yeah, you know, you're going to be judged by your works according to this passage, as if they're applying it to saved Christians, not the dead who were not written in the book of life. They're arguing that you have to get in the book of life by doing the works because of this passage, but it's those who weren't in the book of life that were judged according to their works.
No Nonsense Christianity once published a video refuting Abide in the Word's interpretation of Revelation 20. He was tagged in the description so that YouTube would have notified him about it. As far as I know, he has never publicly responded to my refutation or apologised for bearing false witness to Revelation 20. Another YouTube channel called Destroying the Works of the Devil published a video refuting Truth by Jesus, and I added a comment discussing her false witness to Revelation 20. Instead of repenting of her sin and acknowledging her blatant lies,
she lashed out against me with diatribe about how I am of the devil and we have to turn from sins. Even if it could be said that saved Christians, those in the Book of Life, will be judged by their works according to other passages in the Bible, this does not change the fact that they bore false witness to Revelation 20. It wasn't very difficult to prove that their teaching on this passage was completely erroneous and false. But they are counting on your stupidity. They will get the praise of their unsaved followers who won't identify this blatant claim. And if you post a comment refuting them, your comment may get deleted, you may be blocked from posting, or they will hurl insults at you and quote mine off-topic verses. Abide in the Word and Truth by Jesus know the Bible very well. They have a lot of their go-to verses memorized. They will have read Revelation 20 multiple times. They know what Revelation 20 actually says. They are not merely confused by it. They tell you to turn from your sins when they themselves are filthy, wicked, disgusting, unrepentant liars.
According to this, you were judged based on whether or not your name was written in the Book of Life. And whether or not your name was written in the Book of Life was dependent upon what you had done.
Eternal life and eternal judgment is according to what you did. In Revelation 20:12, Apostle John says, "And I saw the dead, small and great."
Another one of their manipulative tactics is to take a dichotomy in the Bible where there are two opposite things, and then manipulate the definition so that they actually mean the same thing.
So many in the church today are living a life of compromise. They're living a life of sin, living a life of perpetual wickedness, sinning every day in word, thought, and deed. And so this false theology makes the power of sin greater than the power of God's grace.
The Bible never once uses the term power of sin, nor does it ever use the term power of grace. That doesn't automatically mean that it is false, of course, but nowhere does the Bible present that God's giving of grace and the temptation of sin are diametrically opposed. This is not a biblical argument, rather it is an emotional one. Jesse Morell is using emotionally charged terms such as the power of sin and the power of grace so as to emotionally blackmail his listeners into believing his sinlessness salvation doctrine. He is manipulating his listeners into thinking that if you are unable to stop sinning, you cannot possibly be under grace. He will manipulate the definition of grace to justify this.
Grace means that you don't have to sin. The Bible says sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under law, but under grace. And shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. In other words, stop sinning.
The definition of grace is God's unmerited favor. This is why Ephesians 2, in saying that by grace we are saved, describes this as the gift of God and not of yourselves. Jesse Morell has deliberately manipulated Romans 6:14 to interpret sin shall not have dominion over you because you don't sin anymore. But that is not how the verse itself defines sin no longer having dominion over you. The verse describes sin as not having dominion over you because you are under grace, that is, God's unmerited, undeserved favour, and not under law, or the punishments that you deserve for your sins. Paul calls this the law of sin and death. The phrase under law means that if you break a specific law, you face a punishment for that. So like the death penalty, for example. So that's why we are saying that, for example, rich people or politicians who think that the law of the land doesn't apply to them, we have this saying that they think they are above the law. So if we're not under the law, the meaning of that phrase is that the law cannot condemn us to its punishments for breaking it because we're not under the law. We are free from that law. And being free from the law, the Bible calls this liberty. It says we are free. We are free from the guilty verdict of the law. And there's no mixing these two things. We're justified by faith, not by the deeds of the law. And grace is the exact opposite of works. They cannot mean the same thing, nor can they overlap by definition. So what these work salvation, oxygen-thieving children of the devil do is they change the definition of grace to mean the same thing as the law, and then change the meaning of Romans 6:14 to mean that grace means you're obeying the law and not sinning, but under the law means you're disobeying the law and sinning. But that's not what those terms mean. Grace is the exact opposite of law, because the law is debt and grace is of the free gift of sin not imputed. So the biblical definition of grace then, not being under law, the law cannot condemn you for breaking it or trespassing against it, because if it could, well then you would still be under the law, by definition. So sin not having dominion over you has nothing to do with the act of sinning or whether you still sin or don't sin in the act. It has to do with the condemnation of the law over you because of your sin, no longer having a valid verdict against you. And this is why Paul describes the justification by faith as liberty or freedom. When Paul said, "Shall we sin that grace may abound?" According to Jesse Morell's teaching, sin does not abound where grace abounds. So he must accuse Paul of asking a stupid, hypothetical question that makes no sense. So Paul is very clear that where sin abounded, grace abounded much more. So therefore, someone who, theoretically, if they wanted to, could use grace as a green light to just go about and carry on sinning. Well, this is why Paul says, "Shall we continue in sin so that grace may abound?" God forbid. We don't need to make God's grace abound more to prove some kind of a point. That's why Paul also says, "Use not your liberty as an occasion for the flesh." If you could lose your salvation and you have to turn from all sin, as Jesse Morell proclaims, well, then again, Paul would be asking a stupid question, because liberty by definition is not giving an occasion to the flesh. So you couldn't use it to give an occasion to the flesh, even if you wanted to, and it would just be a stupid question. If Paul really meant what Jesse Morell says, then Paul could have said, "Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means, for grace will not abound where sin ceases not, but only those sins before you repented." But that's not what Paul said. He didn't say that. Now, Paul tells them in Romans 6, "You were the servants of sin," past tense, "but you have obeyed that doctrine from the heart, and then being made free from sin, you became the servants of righteousness." But again, he says that that happened in the past tense. But he's telling the Romans, present tense and henceforth, "Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body." So the Romans are already freed from sin, it already happened, they're already servants of righteousness, but he still needs to tell them not to let the act of sinning reign in their bodies. Why does he say this? "Because grace won't abound where you sin." Nope, it's because of the infirmity of your flesh. Paul tells you that very reason. So when Paul says we are free, we have liberty, yes, you are correct that he's not saying you are free to carry on sinning, but he's also not saying that you are free from the propensity to sin, or the habit of sinning, or the desire to sin, or the fleshly nature to sin in the body. He isn't saying either of those two things, so it's a false premise to even be arguing from. Your freedom has nothing to do with the act of sinning. It has to do with the condemnation of the law. You have liberty under grace because you're not under condemnation of the law. That's what words mean. The reason why Jesse Morell must change the definition of grace is because, despite the Bible explicitly stating that we are not saved by works of the law, he nonetheless claims that the repentance that is necessary to gain salvation comes by the law.
Sin, according to 1 John 3:4, says sin is transgression of the law. So to repent of your sin means you change your mind about breaking God's law. If you're an adulterer, you change your mind about committing adultery. If you're a fornicator, you change your mind about committing fornication. If you're a murderer, you change your mind about those things.
If the definition of grace means obeying the law, and under the law means disobeying the law, then you would have to accuse New Testament prophets of being false prophets for describing grace through faith as liberty, and describing the Old Testament law as being unable to bear.
As Paul said, "Awake unto righteousness and sin not." And so by grace we can avoid sinning.
Sinless perfectionists treat grace as some kind of mystical, magical power that God dispenses to believers so that they can, quote, overcome their sins. However, they also believe that if you did turn from all of your sins and get saved, you could also fall back into sin, and in doing so, you could lose your salvation. If this happens, can it really be said that you ever did overcome your sins? Why did God's grace start a work in you but then fail to complete it, if the power of grace is so great? Can we really trust in a God that fails in this way? One that gives you the power to overcome your sin so that you can enter heaven, but then his power is ineffective for the many people that will lose their salvation, as these sinless perfectionists suppose. Jesus made it very clear in John chapter 6 that for a person to believe on Christ and get eternal life, an irreversible transaction has to take place. So in John chapter 6, Jesus said that no man can come to me unless the Father draw him. And earlier in the same chapter, he describes the Father as giving believers onto Jesus. All that the Father gives unto me shall come to me. So in verse 40, when somebody believes on the Son and has everlasting life, the Father has given that person to Jesus. This is a transaction that has taken place. And the preceding verse says that's all that the Father gives unto Jesus, and this is for eternal life. It's not about discipleship or fellowship. It's about salvation, eternal life. I should lose nothing. So Jesus has a mandate here. When Jesus is given a believer by the Father, that person has everlasting life by believing on Jesus. Jesus has a mandate not to lose that person. Now, logically, if he could lose that person would have lost their everlasting life. But Jesus does the will of the Father. He said, I came not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. So Jesus has to succeed at doing the will of the Father. That's his purpose. That's what makes him the Son of God. And the Father's will is that when he gives Jesus a believer to have everlasting life, Jesus should not lose that person. He should not let any be cast out. If Jesse Morell believes that the power of grace sets people free of the propensity to sin, only for many of those people to fall back into sin and lose their salvation, wouldn't that mean that Jesus failed to do the will of God? Wouldn't that make Jesus a loser, a liar, a failure, or at best, a flaky saviour?
The idea that a false gospel creates false converts and only false converts fall away, but Jesus had people fall away, and Jesus didn't preach a false gospel, but yet even he had converts who fell away. But it doesn't say many of his false disciples followed him no more, or many of his disciples followed him no more because they were false. It simply says many of his disciples followed him no more. So even Jesus, who had true disciples, lost them.
Jesus said very clearly in John 6, I should lose nothing. When it documents that some disciples walked no more with him, it does not say Jesus lost them. Of those that walked no more with him, Jesus said very clearly, but there are some of you that believe not, for Jesus knew from the beginning who they were that believed not, and who should betray him. And he uses this statement to qualify what he says in the next verse. Therefore said I unto you that no man can come unto me except it were given unto him of my Father. Jesus was very clear in John chapter 6. Regarding those who have eternal life, all those that the Father gives me shall come to me, and I should lose nothing. And of those disciples that walked no more with him, that he knew from the beginning they believed not, and that no man can come to him, for eternal life that is, except it were given to him of my Father. There is no implication whatsoever that Jesus lost them. Jesus did not fail to do the will of the Father to lose nothing.
Jesus said to the Father, those that you've given me, I've lost none of them, save the son of perdition. In other words, Jesus lost Judas. That's what that verse is saying.
Once again, John 17:12 does not say that Jesus lost Judas. It only says that Judas was lost. Furthermore, John 17:12 is not evidentially about eternal life, but rather it is fulfilled in the next chapter, in chapter 18, verse 9, when Jesus appeals to his captors to let his 11 disciples go and not be arrested, and therefore killed, with him. John 17:12 clearly states that of those you gave me, I have kept. None of them is lost but the son of perdition, Judas, because Jesus did not keep Judas. The reason Jesus did not keep Judas for everlasting life is that Judas was not given to Jesus to inherit eternal life. He was only given as a disciple to betray him so as to fulfill scripture, as per John 13:18. The Bible explicitly says that Jesus should lose nothing. It never says that Jesus lost anybody, only that Judas was lost. According to Jesse Morell, Jesus is either a liar or a failure because he lost Judas.
And the way people read this is that all you have to do is just this nonchalant mental consent that you believe in Jesus, and presto, you're a Christian, you're going to be raised up at the last day and have everlasting life. That's easy believism. That's how people read that Bible verse. But
by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of. So the way of truth, they'll make it evil. They'll call it things like easy believism, or they'll call you Andersonites, or 1, 2, 3, repeat after me, or cheap grace. It's not cheap, is it? It's not cheap, it's Jesus Christ gave himself for us. Cheap grace, they try and call it as well. We don't think you're going to do any work at all, cheap grace. No, your works are cheap, that's what's cheap.
we're going to let the Bible interpret the Bible here. He is asking the Father to keep them. It's not unconditional. And if it was unconditional, look at verse 12. He tells his Father, "Those whom you gave me, I have kept, and none of them is lost except the son of perdition." Well, who's that? Judas Iscariot. Judas Iscariot was lost. You can see that. "And none of them is lost except the son of perdition."
To reiterate, this verse does not say that Jesus lost Judas. It also does not say that Judas being lost was based on any condition. Jesus faithfully kept those who were given to him by the Father. Jesus did not keep Judas because Judas was not given by the Father for eternal life as the other disciples. He was instead chosen by Jesus for the purpose of being a false disciple, so as to fulfill Scripture.
Judas at one time was saved. He was walking with Jesus and he was lost. So you can't possibly read John 6 that you can't be lost. Now notice he says may have everlasting life, not will have, may have. And it's conditioned. They may have everlasting life, not that they will have everlasting life. He didn't say, "I will lose nothing and I will raise it up at the last day." No, he said should, meaning it is conditional.
Another tactic they use is to come up with a logical assertion that sounds like it makes sense biblically, because they're counting on you to be too biblically illiterate to realise that actually their logical assertions have more holes than Swiss cheese. If Keith Wheeler is asserting that because Jesus said, "I should lose nothing," this only means that he might not lose you, but there is no guarantee, why does he also teach that a saved Christian must have works for salvation? Yet he substantiates this with verses that only say we should do works, but not must.
We should live soberly, righteously. How can you sin and be righteous? You can't. Should we continue in our sin because grace has more power over sin? God forbid. That just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should also walk in newness of life. That's it. Do not let sin reign in your mortal body, that you should obey in its lusts, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them.
This blasphemous fool is basically making our Lord out to be a failure. Well, it only says that Jesus should lose nothing. I mean, he might not, it only says he should. Well, okay, then why is all these verses that I should do works? Well, I have to do works. Are you telling me that as a fallen sinner born in mortal flesh, the standard is higher for me than it is for Jesus? That I have to do something that I should do, but Jesus only might do something that he should do? No, he's the Son of God. He fulfilled the will of God perfectly. If Jesus should do something, he will do it. It takes a prideful person to hold himself up to a higher standard doing the will of God than even God's only begotten Son. But Keith Wheeler and Jesse Morell barely reach for the top ranks of just how prideful and self-obsessed a sinless perfectionist can be.
So if you would just follow and listen to his truth, seek him out with all your hearts, repent of all your sins, you would live the kind of life that I am living now.
If you want to go to heaven, you have to be like me. You have to be good.
My teaching, my knowledge comes from no man. It comes strictly from Jesus. I know whether somebody is lying to me or speaking truth. I can tell if somebody's a believer or not. I just know things, and I know them to be fact. I'm not guessing at these things. I know these things. I was taught these things by Jesus Christ himself.
Mike Rakowski is a lone agent. He is not part of any denomination or wide group. He's not in fellowship with anybody else who produces YouTube content, as far as I know. That being said, some of his doctrines do have Pentecostal or charismatic leanings. Some of his doctrines he picked up from reading Smith Wigglesworth devotionals. But then what Rakowski has done is he's cherry-picked a handful of verses in the Bible and formulated his own doctrine that's so unique to him, it doesn't even have an ism to describe it, because you've literally never heard anybody else preach this. So he takes a seemingly random passage from John 17, where Jesus is praying specifically for his 11 disciples, and he prays for them to be sanctified in truth. And then he picks some seemingly random passage from 1 John 4 about testing the spirits, and also the concept of overcoming from that epistle as well. And then he throws it all together to come up with his own version of the gospel. And he ties all this up with salvation and healing and the Christian life, and then everything pivots around these few handpicked verses. So what he constantly talks about on his channel, and he wrote a book about this as well, this is his big thing, is that when you first get the Holy Spirit after, quote-unquote, repenting of your sins and accepting Jesus into your life. That is now the beginning of a difficult sanctification journey that you must undertake, and the end goal is to become a sanctified in truth disciple of Christ who has overcome all sickness and sin and has learned to test the spirits. And only somebody that has reached this status is qualified to teach and preach God's truth or give the gospel or something like that. And he declares that on a planet of 8 billion people, I kid you not, he is the only sanctified in truth disciple who has successfully overcome all sickness and sin in this whole evil, wicked world.
Not long after I had got that gift, I was curious to see if there was people out there that understood what I know. And I went searching and searching the internet for articles on discerning the spirits, testing the spirits, and I heard so many people preaching about it, and none truly know what it's all about.
If you can't find anybody on the planet that agrees with you, you might be starting a cult, right? I mean, if the Holy Spirit's always been around, the Bible's been around, why are you having trouble finding anybody that believes like you? Because you're a cult leader. That's why.
Now, he does have a band of cult followers, we'll get into that in a moment, but they're still in the process. They haven't been born again yet. They're still learning to be sanctified in truth. So you can search the whole world, every language, every corner of every nation on this entire earth, every little micro part of the internet, you will not find anybody else preaching the truth. Only Mike Krakowski preaches the truth in this current generation, apparently. Now, I understand the need to defend oneself against critics. I do it myself. But it seems like this guy tries a bit too hard to vindicate himself, to the point of it being a little bit of a Freudian slip, you might say. Both times, he managed to get his little followers together. They did a film giving their testimonies, and in both videos, he responded to a particular accusation that they are following him rather than following Jesus and the Bible. So he turns to his followers to let them answer for themselves, and this happened both times.
And there's people out there going, oh man, people are following you. They're not following me. I'm not giving them any direction. They can all tell you that. Is that not correct? They hear God. They hear his voice, just like I hear his voice. You know, over and over, people will sit there and say that, you know, they're following me. They're not following me. They'll tell you that. They're not following me.
And he acts like this is proving something. You know, he turned around to his followers and they gave the exact answer that he wanted. Point proven. Well, look, ask a cult follower if they're in a cult. They'll tell you that they're not in the cult. They'll give you the answer that the cult leader wants them to say. Here's how I know that they are actually following the man Mike Krakowski and not God himself. Now, bear in mind that Mike Krakowski figured this stuff all on his own, okay? He had some special revelation from God about his sanctified in truth doctrine because nobody else in the whole world was preaching this truth. They all heard it from Mike Krakowski first. Now, he got it on his own. They got it from him. You know, it's not like Mike Krakowski just happened to stumble upon another sanctified in truth disciple of Christ who's overcome sickness and sin and learned to test the spirits and then, oh, hello brother, let's fellowship together. Another reason that I know they're a cult who's following the man and not the Bible is that in the Bible, the prophets would often say, thus saith the Lord, or it is written. And I often say on my channel, like, the Bible says, okay, that's the verb I use, the Bible says something. Whereas Mike Krakowski often uses the word relating. So he will say, well, God is relating, or people don't understand what the Bible is relating. Now, there's nothing wrong with this word per se, but the Bible doesn't really use this word. It's not like anybody ever said, thus relating the Lord. It's quite specific to Rakowski. Most Christians don't talk like this. And yet these cult followers, if you see them in the comments, they talk like this. Oh, the Bible is relating. Oh, thank you, Mike, for relating what the Lord is doing through you. Relating this, relating that. They constantly use this word. Now, you did not get that lingo from the Bible. You did not get that lingo because that's how you naturally talk, because most people don't talk like that. Mike Krakowski talks like that, and now you're talking like that. You picked up that lingo from him. And I noticed as well that sometimes, like, they would copy and adapt phrases from his book, like, I too can testify that what Mike Krakowski is relating is true, because that's a line from Mike Krakowski's book that he wrote. So you see how his book has now become on par, if not even higher than the Bible itself, and that because they will copy and repeat and adapt phrases from his book as if it's somehow biblical gospel truth. And again, copying his lingo, if you listen to the testimonies of the group video that they did, they keep saying, I first started testing the spirits 2 years ago, or I started testing the spirits 6 months ago. Now, of course, those of us who believe in salvation by grace, we use terms that line up with either biblical language or common Christian language, like, I first got saved 2 years ago, or I first believed the gospel such and such a time ago. But the cult followers copy and repeat the lingo of their cult leader. So because he is the only sanctified in truth disciple, and he has his little cult following, he now has a small army of stupid, irrepressionable people, who will believe anything that he says, and they won't be able to challenge him in any way, because they're not sanctified in truth, and he is. And if they try and refute something that he said, he'll call them a child of the devil, or they're satanic, and he'll tell them to crawl back to their father Lucifer, because that's how he talks to people. Or even if he does respond in a more polite way, he still throws in these sanctimonious, arrogant statements like, "You certainly are showing that you are allowing the devil to deceive you," dot, dot, dot. So even if he's trying to help people and answer people genuinely, he still has to throw in these little sanctimonious, holier-than-thou statements in his comments all the time. He can't just answer a question. And no joke, he thinks he's acting like Jesus when he talks like this, just because there's a few examples of where Jesus did call people names or whatever. But it's not like you read the four Gospels and Jesus does this all the time in every single sentence, like, "You child of the devil, you child of the devil, you are certainly a child of the..." Like, in every single comment. But if the four Gospels read like that, it would be so nauseating to read. So to believe that Mike Rakowski is acting like Jesus when he does these things, you would have to believe that he's even more like Jesus than even Jesus himself.
You would not believe some of the names these people call me, and yet they say they're Christians. I've been threatened and everything else, and yet these people claim to be children of God. The people that try to come against me, of course, I then call them a child of the devil. They, of course, sit there and say, "How can you call me a child of the devil?" Because you are a child of the devil.
Now, Rakowski says that the Bible's got mistakes in it, so he rejects 6 books in the Bible, and he says that in his book that he wrote, the Holy Spirit mysteriously told him that one of the books in the Bible was false and that there's some mistakes in the Bible. So he went and looked it up on the internet, and he found out that there's these disputed epistles by Paul that scholars don't agree on whether they were actually written by Paul or not. So he rejects those books, and he basically threw them out of his Bible. Ephesians, both books of Timothy, Colossians, Titus, and 2 Thessalonians. Now, if you actually do your research on this topic, you will find that scholars are not unanimous about that. They are divided on that issue. The one book in the Bible that scholars are unanimous about, almost, that the book was not written by Paul, is the book of Hebrews. Now, Mike Rakowski doesn't reject the book of Hebrews, and he didn't even bother to mention that little detail in his book. So with these false prophets, sometimes it's not always the things that they do say, it's the things that they decline to tell you because they don't want to give you too much information that would give the game away. And so, because the Bible's apparently got mistakes in it, but Mike Rakowski hears the voice of God and he's the only sanctified in truth disciple in the whole universe, well, now the Bible is no longer the authority. Now, he is the authority. Because if you have a doctrine or a belief about the Bible, and it can't conform to the plain text, it's now got to conform to the voices inside Mike Rakowski's head. And inevitably, that's why there can't be any other sanctified in truth disciples of Christ on this whole planet, because he's not the only person on YouTube to get up and say that I hear the voice of God, just go directly to Jesus and you'll get the same message I'm getting. There's lots of false prophets on YouTube who all have different messages, all claiming to hear the voice of God, including other people who say that they've turned from all of their sins, by the way. But they're counting on you not realising the holes in all of their logic. So Mike Rakowski has this thing about overcoming all of your sickness, and if you follow Mike Rakowski's example, you will never have sickness in your life. Now, whenever people bring up things in the New Testament about believers getting sick, it's always, "Well, you're twisting the scriptures, or you're a child of the devil," or just some, he'll just go off topic, or he'll dodge the question and just throw insults at people. Whenever somebody brings up something in the Old Testament, like, for example, Job, well, Rakowski always says, "Well, that's the Old Covenant, that was before Jesus, there was no forgiveness back then." But that, again, he's counting on the stupidity of his followers because he knows that they won't figure this stuff out. Because if you just look at all the verses, or most of the verses, that Mike Rakowski uses to justify this doctrine, they're all from the Old Testament and Old Covenant, but it's given to the Old Covenant in the law, to the Old Covenant believers. And then you get to the New Testament, and none of the apostles expounded on this teaching at all. Jesus never went back to these verses to make a whole sermon out of it. You know, you read through all of these books in the New Testament, they don't preach this doctrine. They don't go into any detail about this, they don't bother to go back to Deuteronomy and teach this. It's not there. Again, he's counting on his followers to be too stupid to figure this out, because the Bible is no longer the authority. Now Mike Rakowski's the authority, and his followers can only be hearing the voice of God if it agrees with the voices in Mike Rakowski's head.
Everybody's believing that the gospel is all about saving souls, going out and saving, converting people and saving them. That couldn't be any further from the truth. It's actually a selfish gospel when you look at it. You know, the gospel is about you letting Jesus Christ live through you, being a true disciple of Jesus Christ.
And you preach a false gospel, clearly, time and again. You're not just unsaved, you're a reprobate false prophet, aren't you? Amen. You're wicked, you're twice dead. Yeah, you're done. That is wicked. That's the most wicked thing pretty much you can do, isn't it? You're preaching people to hell. You're preaching a lie.
You don't want other people to be saved. You hate God's people. You hate grace when you reject it. When you add your works to it, you hate it.
Mike Rakowski claims to have overcome all sin. It is now impossible for him to sin.
There is nothing inside of me that will allow me to sin. Why? Because I'm following Jesus. I'm allowing Jesus to guide me in my life.
Let's put his claims to the test. This woman is Mike Rakowski's wife, Linda. As one of the members of this group, she too is learning to overcome all sickness and sin and test the spirits. Notice that she has short hair. Here is a picture taken from several years ago when they went on holiday, while Mike Rakowski still believed he was overcoming sin. She had even shorter hair back then. She has had more than enough time to grow it out. The Bible says it is a shame unto Christ for a woman to have short hair. This teaching is very, very clear in the book of Corinthians, which is one of the books Mike Rakowski doesn't reject. She's also wearing a cross around her neck, which is basically a molten image. It's Catholics and other pagans that like to wear religious symbols about their person. Now look, if you're watching this and you're a woman who has short hair, look, I'm not having a go at you. Don't take this attack personally. But if you are a woman and you're going to have short hair, don't go around telling the rest of us about how you're overcoming all of your sins and you live this obedient lifestyle. Either have short hair and believe in salvation by grace, or grow your hair long or shut up. Stop trying to make excuses to justify your sin while telling everybody else that you're turning from your sins. If Mike Rakowski has overcome all sin and has surrendered everything to the Lord, why isn't he bringing his wife under subjection? Why does he have a special exemption for his wife to disobey the Corinthian order? Why is his own wife bringing shame unto Christ?
You say there's the only proof that you have the Holy Spirit is if you're acting a certain way. It's funny because these people will always think that they're acting good enough to prove that they're saved. But then if someone else isn't living the way they are, then that person probably isn't saved. Like their standard for righteousness is like their own lifestyle. You're just like the Pharisees, exactly like them. A bunch of religious, self-righteous, hypocritical Pharisees. You are a hypocrite.
Let's see another example of him imposing rules on others, yet making himself exempt from his own rules.
All of these, I've seen this over and over, where these once saved, always saved people always sit there and say, oh, we're saved by grace. Well, guess what? There is not one scripture verse that ever uses that term that you are saved by grace.
Actually, there's two verses that say this, but see, the simple fact that he can make this claim just shows you how stupid he is, how spiritually blind he is. He's not just unsaved, he's a hellbound reprobate.
Now, in this original video, he doesn't allude to the fact that he rejects Ephesians, but basically, he's attacking that other guy that you just heard, Jack Smack, and arguing that, well, Ephesians says by grace you are saved, not saved by grace, as if there's a difference between these two things. Therefore, there is not one scripture verse that uses this term, and therefore the term is false. He also asserts that once saved, always saved is false because there is not one scripture that uses that term.
If Rakowski asserts that something is not true simply because there is not one scripture verse that ever uses such exact term, he wouldn't dare make up his own terms that can't be found in the Bible, would he?
Once you accept Jesus into your life.
Nowhere does the Bible ever use that term, accept Jesus into your life.
Once you repent of your sins.
Nowhere does the Bible ever use that term, repent of your sins.
Surrendering to God means literally.
There is not one scripture verse that ever uses that term, surrendering to God.
That it's possible to live a life where you can overcome sin and sickness.
There is not one scripture that ever uses that term, overcoming sin and sickness. You can look up overcome, overcame, overcometh or overcomes. You will not find sin or sickness in any of those verses that use the word overcome.
Jesus said that you shall be judged by the measure which you judge others. Why does Mike Rakowski denounce others as preaching false doctrine for using extra-biblical phrases when he does the same thing himself? After all, he did say that he has overcome all of his sins. He did say that he has given everything to Jesus. He did a video on the internet and said so. Therefore, it must be true.
Now, the Bible is the most important tool that we have as a weapon of spiritual warfare. If you go around saying, God told me this and God told me that, I can't test that, but I can test this. And the Bible itself emphasizes the importance of written words. Over and over and over again in this Bible, you will find that it says, it is written, it is written, it is written. The Bible warned you about adding and removing from the words. Jesus himself read the scrolls in the synagogues and referred to scripture, and he would quote scripture, even though theoretically he didn't have to. The Bible even calls Jesus himself the Word, and Jesus often emphasized the importance of his words, like, my words are life, my words will never pass away. And we can only know what words Jesus actually said because we have the Bible. So these reprobates, these devils, they know that they can't just reject the Bible and just say it's false, because then their father Lucifer is not a threat to you. So being subtle like their father, they need to pretend that they're actually honouring the God of this book, while subtly negating its authority and changing the word of God into a lie. Some of them will say that it has mistakes in it, so don't trust too much what's in it. But I hear God, so I'll tell you what that really meant to say.
He tells me what is right in the Bible, what is wrong in the Bible, because he has pointed out many things to me that are not factual truth.
Some of them pretend that they know things that you don't, so they have to rewrite the Bible and change what it says.
This is why you need to abandon your English Bibles and come over and start reading our translation as we finish it, because it is literally a translation of what is written in the original language.
Ron Craig goes as far as to write his own Bible because it seems that nobody else on this planet of 8 billion people can properly translate the Hebrew or Greek in a way that he approves of with his expert knowledge. So let's just handpick a few passages from this rooted word translation. Now, we start here with 1 Peter 1. Now, the English, it's a little bit of a tricky passage to understand. I appreciate that, but the English that the King James uses is still fairly straightforward, even if it's a little bit difficult to understand what Peter's talking about. So we take like verse 2, for instance. Elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father through sanctification of the Spirit unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. Seems to make sense. According to the rooted word translation, it should say, according to a foreknowledge of Father God and in terrifying cleanness of spirit, whatever that means, into a humble way of listening underneath to obey. Well, that statement right there, that doesn't even make grammatical sense in English. And into a sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ, cheerful grace to you and might peace be filled up. And again, that doesn't make grammatical sense either. Verse 4, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled and that fades not away, reserved in heaven for you. Pretty straightforward verse, not particularly complicated. He begets us into an unshriveled and untainted and unextinguished partitioning of allotment, having been guarded attentive. I mean, does anybody understand what that means? I have no idea what that means. Doesn't make sense. Verse 6, wherein you greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, you are in heaviness through manifold temptations. A little bit of a tricky verse, but the English is fairly straightforward. About this final occasion, you are jumping for joy a tiny bit, even if just now it is a binding, limiting, being saddened in manifold piercing. Again, that doesn't make grammatical sense. That sentence doesn't mean anything. It's just word salad. Here's another passage, Romans chapter 8. Fairly straightforward. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh but after the Spirit. Without doubt now, there is not even one appropriate distinction for decision against those. What does that mean? I have no idea. For what the law could not do, verse 3, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned sin in the flesh. Again, fairly straightforward verse, plain English. For the powerless of the law, in which it was weak through the flesh, the God dispatches his own Son in the similarity of flesh of lacking allotment and about lacking allotment, distinguishes accordingly the lack of allotment in the flesh. What on God's planet does that mean? That doesn't mean anything. It's just word salad. That is not a translation. He's just throwing random words together. 1 John 3. Sinless perfectionists drool with excitement over this chapter. Whosoever commits sin transgresses also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law. Straightforward verse, perfectly simple to understand. Everyone doing the sin in its deprivation of allotment also is doing the lawlessness, and the sin in its deprivation of allotment is the lawlessness. And it doesn't make grammatical sense. What is this guy's obsession with allotments? Some gardening fetish? I don't know what this is. This makes no sense. It doesn't make grammatical sense. Nobody in English is going to understand this. I'm reading the common version. I'm not even reading the precise version. Imagine how difficult the precise version is going to be. The common one makes no sense. So this Bible that uses simple English that's easy to understand and was translated by over 50 expert scholars, they're all wrong, but I, Ron Craig, I'm special. I know what it really says. Here you go. It doesn't make sense. This is not readable. Nobody's going to go with this translation. It's garbage. But you see, if he can get people to read this translation and they don't understand it, now they're going to have to go to him to help them understand it. So they're going to interpret it in the way that he wants them to. Now, as you can imagine, that inconvenient verse in Revelation that talks about not adding and removing from the words of the book of this prophecy, you can bet that this has certainly been changed, hasn't it? I am testifying to everyone listening to the words of the prophecy of the book of these things, in case that anyone may place around about these, that God might place around about him these poundings out. Again, it doesn't make grammatical sense. And in the case that anyone may be lifted up for one's own sake from off to the words, from off of the words of the book of this prophecy, that God might lift up off the allotment of, again, it makes no sense, from off the timber of the life, and from the terrifyingly clean city. Now, again, he has another thing about this terrifyingly clean business. You see, he says that the word saints in the Bible means terrifyingly clean ones. I asked a native Greek speaker about that. She looked at me like it was the craziest thing she'd ever heard. It was ridiculous. So look, nobody's going to go for this translation. It's absolute garbage. It doesn't make any sense. He's making this translation so he can put ideas into your head that you would never get from reading the Bible. And even Greek speakers don't get this from reading their Bible. I mean, look, if this guy thinks that he's some kind of Greek or Hebrew expert, can you imagine this guy going to Greece and trying to order a glass of water in a restaurant? That one that is about the allotment of my eatings, I bestow upon him that which is asking, so he might extend his terrifyingly washed appendage that he is reaching forth to circumnavigate the receptacle of water to my holy table. It's ridiculous. Greek people don't speak like this. Nobody in English talks like this. He's writing his own fake Bible version to promote his false doctrine. He has been blotted out of the book of life. That is wicked. It's evil.
I stopped sinning. Have you stopped sinning? You better stop sinning. Stop sinning. I absolutely guarantee you're going to hell if you don't stop sinning, because you know the scriptures. God has a special punishment reserved for you in the lake of burning sulfur, which is eternal. And I will be partying in the city of God, celebrating and singing praises to the Lamb of God and to God our Father, because you are being tormented for your wicked, wicked evil.
Some of them say that, well, it's not that important. You don't need the Bible. God's outside of the Bible. So they can change God to be one in their own image rather than the one the Bible actually describes.
I am here to testify about the true God. You do not need a church. You don't need religion, and you don't need a Bible. You don't have to go to church. You don't have to be a part of anyone's religion, and you also don't have to read the Bible. He's the one who gives me the messages that I put up. Those messages don't come from me. I don't contrive them.
So these sons of Belial, they put on this outward show that they love God with all of their heart and all of their soul, and they obey all of his commandments. And they go about in the woods every day being all super spiritual because they've forsaken this world. But like their father the devil, masquerading as an angel of light, they've changed the God of the Bible. Because in reality, they don't love God. They've made up God in their own image, some idol that they've fashioned after their own likeness. Just like Old Testament idolaters and just like the Pharisees. Because they hate the God that's actually described in this Bible. Over and again in this Bible, you will find condemnation of false prophets. The people who know what the Bible says come out saying this.
Because as the scripture says, all you got to do is confess with your mouth and believe, you know, and believe in your heart that, you know, Jesus was risen from the dead, and you will be saved. So yes, you will be, if you believe that, you'll be saved. But now you got to allow the Spirit to do its work in you and allow you to grow. Well, here's the problem. A lot of people don't allow it to happen.
Well, I know that the Bible says that God saves us by grace and not works. I don't like that. I'm offended by that. So I'm going to say the opposite. And I'm going to say that no, God will save us by works.
That their works, that they turn from their evil way, when God saw those works, he gave them mercy. It was their works that brought about mercy. It was their turning from sin, their repentance, that save them.
Well, I know that the Bible says salvation is a free gift, so I'm going to say that it has a cost.
You got to turn from what you love. You got to turn from your sins. You got to count the cost.
Well, I know that Jesus said about eternal life, I should lose nothing, so I'll pluck some random verse about Judas, and I'll say that Jesus lost Judas. And I know that's not what that verse says, but I'm just going to count on my listeners being too stupid to notice.
In other words, Jesus lost Judas. That's what that verse is saying.
Judas Iscariot was lost. He was saved at one time.
Well, I know that the Bible says, it is written, it is written, it is written, do not add, do not take away, the words will last forever, and so on. But no, it's got mistakes in it. But trust me, bro, I know what it really says.
He tells me what is right in the Bible, what is wrong in the Bible.
You need to abandon your English Bibles and come over and start reading our translation as we finish it.
Well, I know I criticized other people for using a phrase that's never once in the Bible, but I'm going to come out with my own phrases that aren't in the Bible.
Where in the Bible does it say we're forgiven of our present and future sins?
There is not one scripture verse that ever uses that term.
The idea that future sins are covered is not in the Bible, and that's a blatant lie. That's a seducing spirit.
So what do they do? Come up with their own words and phrases that are not found in the Bible.
You have to submit to doing things God's way, surrendering everything you have and follow in Jesus' footsteps.
Get us to a place where we're willing to have a full surrender.
Surrendering to God means literally giving up your life in this world.
You must surrender your life.
Why do they do this? Well, because they're evil, wicked, narcissistic people with delusions of grandeur. And remember that Satan himself wanted to be like the Most High. That was his goal. And I've noticed that a lot of these sinless perfectionists use this weird language that magnifies themselves and brings down God on a sort of a psychological level. So their narcissism can be seen in some of the grandiose language that they use. Like they might say, well, once we fully surrendered, then God can do his bit.
Now, being reborn is something God does once we fully surrendered. This is something that God does once we believed in him and chosen to surrender our life to him.
You need to allow God into your life.
You know, the gospel is about you letting Jesus Christ
listen to
God's voice and allow him to
me.
He is showing me how to allow him.
He's waiting for you to allow him. He's not doing this and God's not doing that and God won't do this because you need to allow him to do it. Well, I've got news for you. The Holy Spirit is God. He doesn't need my permission. What sort of self-righteous, narcissistic I am uses terms like, I allow God, I give you permission, God. Yeah, thanks for dying for me, Jesus. Yeah, that's great, whatever. But listen, I have a special gift for you, God. Mwah. So now with these self-absorbed I ams, it's not while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. It's no, you need to die to yourself and take up the cross and turn from your sins. They're wrong about what deny self means, by the way. But if you can do that, then you'll be acceptable to God. Christ isn't the offering, you're the offering.
It's not about us accepting Jesus. It's not about us accepting Jesus. It's about Jesus accepting you. And he's only going to accept those who repent and forsake all known sin.
So you're in debt to Christ. That's how this guy views his salvation, that he is a debtor. But once you become a debtor to the law, you're a debtor to the whole law.
So they will attack us and say, well, you're just looking for a license to sin. You just want to make excuses to justify your sin.
He's trying to justify why he still sins, why he has sin and sickness in his life.
Some doctrines will help a man in his sin. There's a lot of doctrinal justifications for sin.
Here's what upsets me is that when people say, you know, oh, you believe that all you have to do is believe and get saved and that's it. Yeah, well, why don't we just go murder and rob and rape and pillage? And this is what I think to myself, I'm saved and I've never thought that. Is that what you want to do? Because I've never wanted to do something like that. Rob, rape, you know, it's like I got saved, you know, July 22nd, 2007 is just like, all right, time to go rob a liquor store. Time to go murder that one dude I never really liked. The thought never even came into my mind, my friends. Such a weird example to give. And there's plenty of people in this room, there's plenty of people in churches that believe in the right salvation that have never had that thought ever come into their mind. It's typically the repent of your sins crowd that has that thought, because they're the ones who came up with the illustration. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh, my friends. And guess what? Out of the heart proceed evil thoughts!
Well, what's your excuses for your sins? What's your excuse, Jesse Morell, for manipulating the definition of grace to mean the same thing as the law? How are you going to justify your false witness to what Romans actually said in your blatant disregard for God's plan of salvation at the judgment? What's your excuse, why city preachers, Keith, for preaching loss of salvation by saying that Jesus lost Judas, based on a verse that doesn't say that Jesus lost Judas, and the Bible explicitly says that Jesus should lose nothing, and I will in no wise cast out? How are you going to justify calling our Lord a failure and a loser? What's your excuse, Ron Craig, for pretending that you know Greek and Hebrew better than everybody else on this planet, that you wrote your own fake Bible version that's so ridiculous it doesn't even make grammatical sense in English, nobody can understand it, so you can run a little cult where everybody has to come to you to figure out what it really means? How are you going to justify hiding the true word of God from people? What's your excuse, Mike Krakowski, when you say that on a planet of 8 billion people, you're the only sanctified in truth disciple of Christ who's overcome sickness and all sin, when you can't even bring your own wife under subjection because she has short hair, and the Bible says it is a shame for a woman to have short hair? So I've turned from all of my sins, but your own wife is disobeying that scripture. And why did you nitpick at Jack Smack for saying, nowhere in the Bible does it say saved by grace? When it says by grace you are saved, it's just the same phrase in a different word order. But then you yourself say surrender. The word surrender is not found once in this Bible. So why are you going around calling everybody false for using unbiblical phrases when you do it as well? What excuses are you going to make for that, Mike Rakowski, you wicked filthy whoremonger for Satan? What's your excuse, Adam, from abiding the word and truth by Jesus, for saying that Revelation 20 says that the people in the book of life are going to be judged by their works, when that's the exact opposite of what the Bible actually says? Sick of it. How are you going to justify being a false prophet before Jesus Christ, you oxygen-thieving wastes of space? What was your excuse, Reuben Israel, for being a fat, gluttonous pig who shoved filthy cross-dressers in front of my face? And why are all your followers constantly making excuses for your wicked sins? What's your excuse, Michaela Cooper, for telling me to surrender my life to Christ when the Bible says that I was dead in sin and Christ laid his life down for me? What's your excuse for preaching the gospel in the exact opposite way that the Bible actually says? What's your excuse, Jeff Olet, for telling everybody else that they need to obey and they need to stop smoking and drinking and all this kind of stuff?
You give your life to Christ and you have a problem. What do you do if you got a drinking problem? You take it to him and he what does he do? He delivers you. You know, you have a smoking marijuana problem. You take it to God and he delivers you. You don't make excuses. Oh, well, it says, you know.
When you smoke yourself, why are you putting all of that gunk in your body that's the temple of the Holy Ghost if you're so sure that we have to turn from all of our sins?
You had a basketball player. First off, he wanted to be a Muslim. Well...
What's your excuse, Andrew Tyner, for saying that it's idolatrous to call the Bible the Word of God when it literally says multiple times in this Bible, thus saith the Word of the Lord, this is what the prophet would say? Why are you filthy false prophets exempt from the rules? Why don't you turn from your own sins? Why do you make excuses for your sins? Because you're filthy, disgusting, space-wasting, hell-bound hypocrites, that's why.
They're scum! They're absolute scum! They're not just unsaved, they're scum!
And so they're threatened by anybody who preaches grace because it offends their high opinion that they have about themselves. They hate it when you shine the light on their darkness because they're like cockroaches that want to flee back to the disgusting, dark hole that they crawled out of.
There are certain people who are just garbage. They contribute nothing good. They have no hope of salvation.
And look, people, these false prophets, they're not just merely unlearned. They're not people who just got mixed up and they mean well, but they get it wrong. They know full well what the Bible says. They know what the definition of grace is when they pretend that it means something else. They know what believing on the Lord for salvation means when they pretend that it means doing works. They know that Jesus said about eternal life, I should lose nothing and I will not let any be plucked out of my hand. They know that shepherds don't just let sheep wander off. They know that that's not how shepherding works. They know that salvation is a free gift and free gifts don't cost anything. They know that when Jesus said sin no more, he never mentioned eternal life to those two people. It wasn't a salvific requirement. They know that when Jesus said deny self and take up the cross, that conversation had nothing to do with fleshly sins. They know that when the word repent is used in any of these New Testament gospel passages, it's never followed by the words of your sins. They know that the word surrender was never uttered by Christ or the apostles. They know these things. They're not confused by these things. But they think you're stupid. They think you're a retard. They tell you to turn from your sins when they themselves are filthy, evil, wicked false prophets, hypocrites.
Filthier than any literal whore who has ever walked down the streets of a downtown area.
Twice dead reprobates, worthy of the greater condemnation, the most disgusting of all sinners.
You say, well, God can redeem. Yeah, you know, they can redeem plastic and metal and paper, but they can't redeem dung.
They're wicked. They're working for Satan. It's not even about doing works. It's just about preaching a false gospel that damns people to hell. All they care about is fulfilling Galatians chapter 1, verses 8 and 9, preaching an accursed gospel. That's their whole motive. That's their whole objective, is just to pervert the gospel.
There is so much more I wanted to say about these people, to expose their hypocrisy. There are many more false prophets of this ilk, whom I simply did not have enough time in the documentary to cover. The list of their hypocrisies is endless.
There are people that are just scum, they're trash, they're evil. You can't fix them!
So why, you guys get up, you preach so negative, you preach so mean, you're so angry. No, we are loving, it's just love hates. Somebody tells, next time somebody tells you, oh, you're so hateful, just say, no, love hates.
And look, they'll preach both sides of their mouth, won't they? Yeah. They'll preach the right thing at one point, and they'll preach the lies at the next point, but they're scum. They're absolute scum. They're not just unsaved, they're scum.
So watch out for these stupid fools, these bastards. Just look at them, going around preaching a false gospel, going around perverting the scripture, going around mocking grace and calling it easy believism. That's not good works. That's just the default lifestyle of these stupid reprobates.
They hate God. God hates them. They go in the trash. Amen. They're filled with murder. They're murderers. They hate God. They hate the children of God.
Grace-hating reprobates reject Romans 4:5. They would reject clear verses even when they're presented with them, and they believe the exact opposite of the biblical text.
You don't want other people to be saved. You hate God's people. You hate grace when you reject it, when you add your works to it. You hate it because you think you're more deserving.
Francis Chan teaches the false gospel of worked salvation. And he has also said some very perverse things about God. This man is a disgrace, and he has led millions of people to hell.
I think they've done a lot of damage to a lot of Christians, this teaching of Lordship salvation that they've propagated.
John MacArthur, he's a false prophet that's loved by many and trusted by many, and he's deceiving many people. He's teaching a clear as day work salvation.
And this isn't someone who's ignorant about the gospel message in terms of imputed righteousness. She is coming with a direct assault on her.
This is very serious. And we have to understand this, okay? This is a non-negotiable within the body of Christ. We cannot accept the shitty gospel, okay, of Ray Comfort, John MacArthur et al., and anyone on YouTube who says you must turn from your sins and trust the Savior, or turn from your sins, stop sinning, and do righteousness.
Now, I detest Lordship salvation with a passion, just like how obviously God detests it and every other saved person out there when they realize what it is. When you meet God on your deathbed, you will have to say to him, Jesus has done the works for me. We just have to receive this. We received the free gift. We received the vehicle. Yet you're going to have to tell him, hey, well, I was a good person, I did this, and I don't deserve this. And then he's going to remind you of all the things that you did that you thought you've made up for.
Repent of your sins to be saved. This is total hypocrisy. The people who teach this haven't repented of their sins. If you still sin, you haven't turned from your sins. If the people who teach this are the biggest sinners on this planet, teaching a false gospel, sending people to hell, being spiritual murderers.
Is that all you do is teach Christ and him crucified? You know, the gospel, that's all you do is preach the gospel, the cross. You don't got the good works. You don't go out and feed people and do good things for a reward in heaven. You know, you don't do dead works, then you ain't saved.
Ooh, I love works, especially works of the law.
But for the unbeliever, they reject this free gift of salvation, and they die without Christ. The first thing they will realize is that they are falling down because hell is a bottomless pit.
The Bible tells us in Romans 3:10 and 3:23 that there is none righteous, no, not one, that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And in Romans 5, chapter 5, verse 12, wherefore as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned.
More and more, we're seeing work salvation creep in. A salvation where there's something that I have to do to somehow earn the right to be saved or somehow be qualified to be saved through my own righteousness, through some goodness about myself or through some kind of a turning over of a new leaf or something like that. And they'll attack people who believe like us and call us easy believism. Yes, it's easy to be saved. Yes, all you have to do is believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ did the hard part when he died on the cross for our sins. We just have to believe, and it's easy to receive a gift, isn't it? Amen. It's easy to eat a piece of bread, like Jesus said, I'm the bread of life. It's easy to open a door, as he said, I'm the door. If any man shall enter in by me, he shall be saved, he shall go in and out and find pasture. It's easy to take a drink of water. He said, if you drink of the water that I give you, he said, it'll spring up in you a well, springing unto everlasting life. It's easy to be saved. They'll also call it this, I heard this again just out sold in the last few weeks, cheap grace. That's what someone told us when we were out sowing. He said, oh, you believe in cheap grace. Let me tell you something. The blood of Jesus Christ is not cheap. And that's what I'm relying on for my salvation. Jesus Christ's dead, burial, and resurrection wasn't cheap. It was the most precious thing that's ever existed on this earth. What's cheap is those who believe that their good works are getting them better. That's cheap. It's cheap when they think that you have to go to church and live a good life. That's what's cheap. It's cheap to put enough gas in your tank to drive to church. It's cheap to buy a nice suit of clothes and come to church. But what's not cheap is salvation through Jesus Christ alone. So what we don't believe in is cheap grace. It has nothing to do with the cost. It has to do with who paid for it. We just believe that Jesus paid for it and that we don't have to pay it all. So instead of cheap grace, I don't believe in cheap grace. I'll take it a step further. I believe in free grace. God's word needs to be preached clearly, distinctly, and plainly. And if it's not, the result is confusion. Number one, there is confusion about salvation. And I'll tell you why. People are getting a mixed message and it's confusing them. It's confusing them. You see, there's nothing confusing about this, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. There's nothing confusing about that. There's nothing confusing about, for by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. There's nothing confusing about, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to every one that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. There's nothing confusing about that. There's nothing confusing about whosoever believeth that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone that loveth him that begat, loveth him also that is begotten of him. There's nothing confusing about whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God. God dwelleth in him, and he in God. There's nothing confusing about the fact that the Bible says, what must I do to be saved? And the answer is, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved in thy house. See, there's nothing confusing about it. He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life. But he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. There's nothing confusing about John 6:47. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me hath everlasting life. There's nothing confusing about Jesus saith unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. There's nothing confusing about, verily, verily, I say unto thee, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. There's nothing confusing about salvation when he said, but to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. There's nothing confusing about the gospel. There's nothing confusing about salvation. But the reason people are confused is because they're getting a mixed message. Because right. One minute it's all faith, and then the next minute it's repent of your sins. It's confusing. Which one is it? You say repenting of your sins is part of faith. Liar! No, it isn't. Because repenting of your sins has to do with your sins, and faith has to do with believing in Jesus. They're two totally different things.
That's right.
You see, repenting of your sins is something you should do every day. Die daily. Take up the cross daily. Crucify the flesh daily. Take up the cross and follow him daily. That happens every day. It's not something that happens one time at salvation. See, salvation is not turning over a new leaf.
We have the message of salvation. We can keep you from hell. If you would just believe this message. And the most loving thing we can do is bring you the message of salvation and try to give you the opportunity to be saved. Now look, if you don't get saved, that's between you and God. But we want to be able to say, we did everything in our power to get you the gospel. That's love, not hate.
So when you have the righteousness of God in you, it doesn't get better than that. You cannot add to the righteousness of God. And I think that's what a lot of these people think they can do in the flesh.
You know, we don't celebrate sin. We, you know, unfortunately, we are sinners by nature. The Bible says man loves darkness rather than light. We are naturally diverted in this flesh. And until we're in a glorified state someday when there's going to be new heavens and earth.
The proof of salvation is that I believe the gospel. That I've trusted in Christ alone as my Savior. I don't look to myself and my own, what I perceive to be my fruits, as a proof that I'm saved. No, I point to Christ.
Should we, as believers, be careful to maintain good works? Of course. But those works don't save us, those works don't keep us saved, and those works don't prove our salvation. Salvation is not of works, lest any man should boast.
The Bible declared salvation a free gift. The Bible said that no man can glory in God's presence. Those who sneak works of obedience into salvation, in whatever form they may take, are themselves filthy, evil, disgusting, wicked sinners. They will have their portion with the hypocrites. Yes, it was the act of sinning that made us sinners that need saving. But the law was the cause of our problem, not the solution to it. You will not be cleared of your guilty verdict by turning from all of your sins. Because all of your past sins still hang on your record, and those who preach this still sin themselves, only adding to their hypocrisy and condemnation. Only by being cleansed of your sins and justified in the name of Jesus can your guilty verdict be wiped away through faith, not works. It must be understood that I am for preaching against sin, and I am for preaching holiness, but it must be decoupled from salvation. Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. Nevertheless, where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. I hope this documentary has edified you to see the absurdity, foolishness, and hypocrisy of those who teach, repent of your sins to be saved. The gospel is the good news about what Jesus did. It's not about what you do. Anybody who says otherwise is preaching a false gospel and is to be rebuked, marked and avoided.
Salvation is described by God in absolutes. What does that mean? Is that he describes justification as one event that happens and it's settled, it's done. No more revisiting it. He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life. He that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. I mean, that's kindergarten terms right there. Right? He that believeth hath eternal life. He that believeth not shall not see life. What's going to happen to him? The wrath of God abideth on him. Pretty simple. Because the only one who's able to keep all of God's commandments is God himself. This is why Jesus Christ came, because he fulfilled all the law and the prophets. That's why he's the worthy one. That's why he's the only one that can save us. Look at Romans 4, Well, I just think that if you believe on Jesus Christ, you should do good works, though. They should follow. You know, you should. Well, okay, you can believe that if you want, but that's not what the Bible teaches. Look at verse 4. Now to him that worketh is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt. All the works-based salvation people hate this next verse. But to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. Yeah, but you should have works. Okay, I give you that. You should have works. But if you don't, his faith is still counted for righteousness. Yeah, but I think that, like, if you're saved, it should cause you to just love the Lord in such a way that you do good works. Okay, whatever. But if not, well, don't you think that if someone really just loves God and they just love the Bible, that they're gonna want to do good works for God? Yeah. But if they don't, his faith is still counted for righteousness. But what if his faith is still counted for righteousness? Because to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. Amen. His works aren't counted for righteousness. The Bible says that our works are as filthy rags in the eyes of God. Amen. Look at John 6, verse 34. Then said they unto him, Lord, evermore give us this bread. And Jesus said unto him, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger. Why is he so extreme? I'll tell you why, because what he's referring to is salvation. And if you eat of this bread, referring to Jesus Christ, you'll never hunger. Now, he's not referring to, like, physical, because whoever ate bread during this time, they were still hungry thereafter. He's referring to the fact that he satiates the need for salvation. Will never hunger, he that believeth on me shall never thirst. But I say unto you that ye also have seen me and believe not. Look at verse 37. All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and listen to this, and him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. Now pay attention to that phrase, no wise. Does anybody know what that phrase means? It's not a phrase that we would commonly use today. What does no wise mean? In no way, under any circumstance, under any condition, for any reason. Yeah, but if you could, shut up! Under any reason whatsoever, I will never cast you out. That's what he's saying.
I know God. I'm not guessing at these things.
I know these things. I was taught these things.
You know, the gospel is about you.
What he's been doing with me these
six. I was curious to see if there was people out there
truly know what it's all about.
Whether somebody is lying,
I can tell, or somebody's a believer.
I just know things, and I know them to be fact.
Now I'm sanctified in truth.
I totally understand his truth.
I understand what he's telling me.
I know God.
So I'm living in a life that few people will live.
You know, the gospel is about you.
Die!
You're not just unsaved, you're a reprobate false prophet, aren't you? You're wicked, you're twice dead.
All those idols I got rid of as quickly as I could.
God needs to shut your mouth.
Gave up all my sin, gave up all my friends.
Which sins did you repent of? Because if you're going to tell me that you repented of all of them, you're a liar, is what you are.
When you repent from your sins or claim to have repented, there should be an observable change in your behavior.
The truth of the matter is that these people do not practice what they preach. They don't live up to their own standard.
We have to choose to give our lives to Christ. We have to choose to cooperate with his grace.
Hell is going to be hot for these liars, isn't it? Hell is going to be real hot for these liars.
You don't get into heaven by faith alone.
Shut up! His faith is still counted for righteousness.
If you're not really seeking the Lord on your knees every day in prayer and reading his word, then you're not ever going to get to full surrender. You're not ever going to be reborn.
They're scum. They're absolute scum. They're not just unsaved, they're scum.
Well, if you become a Christian, you've been robbing banks. You don't change your mind about robbing banks and keep robbing banks. You stop robbing banks.
It's either by Jesus alone in him, because he is the only person that has power to forgive sins, not you, not yourself, rare discomfort.
When they repent of their sin and believe the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Really, John? How about the fact that you kept a known pedophile on your staff?
A person is justified by works and not by faith alone.
Twisting of James chapter 2, faith without works is dead. You guys don't even understand that because you're not saved and you're in darkness.
There is not one scripture verse that ever uses that term that you are saved by grace.
Well, actually, there's two verses that say this, but see, the simple fact that he can make this claim just shows you how stupid he is, how spiritually blind he is. He's not just unsaved, he's a hellbound reprobate.
St. John the Baptist says, bring forth works worthy of repentance.
You're done. That is wicked. That's the most wicked thing pretty much you can do, isn't it? You're preaching people to hell. You're preaching a lie.
And of course, I do believe in abortion.
We hate false prophets. Jesus said, beware of false prophets.
It's not about us accepting Jesus. It's about Jesus accepting you. And he's only going to accept those who repent and forsake all known sin.
Stupid, unsaved, hellbound hypocrites.
It was their works that brought about mercy. It was their turning from sin, their repentance, that saved them.
Shut up! His faith is still counted for righteousness.
Eternal life and eternal judgment is according to what you did.
Die!
You gotta turn from what you love. You gotta turn from your sins. You gotta count the cost.
Die!
The reason that you're feeling like killing yourself after I preach the difficult and challenging words of Jesus and of the Bible.
Die!
And you don't need a Bible.
Die!
I will be glad and I will be partying in the city of God, celebrating because you are being tormented in the lake of burning sulfur.
Die!